for the last time. I know you're excited about that.
Last time.
Come on. Gas and go. First question, DW. Will Greg Biffle win 10 or more races this season? He already has five.
He already has five, yes.
Okay, and he has 21 more chances. What do you think, Jeff? Yes?
You got to be kidding me. The competition's getting ready to pick up.
No.
How much you want to bet?
The way that car runs on the mile and a half racetracks, and where are we going in the next few weeks? Kansas City, Chicago, Michigan. Mark my words.
All right. We have a disagreement. Jeff, this $20. For you. Who do you think will be driving the number six of the number two cars next season? So, obviously, the replacements for Rusty and Mark.
I think that the six car is still kind of up in the air. But the two car, believe it or not, a name that keeps coming back and coming on every time I turn around, Martin Truex Jr. They say the deal's not done at DEI, and he's still being pulled by the purse strings.
All right. Who's going after him, by the way?
That's it.
Penske. Okay, I just want to make sure. All right. DW, this is for you. Will we see more retirement announcements before the end of the season? There's some drivers?
Well, there's a couple of guys that could. You know, Ricky Rudd's hanging around there, and, you know, he's got to be thinking about it. Jarrett's got to be thinking about it. We already know that Kenny Schrader's going to run one more year, so, yeah, we're going to hear some more.
All right, good. As long as you guys don't retire, we'll be okay. All right, we'll move on to the next one here. Jeff, will the road courses shake up the point standings? Daryl talked about it at the top of the show. What about from your point of view?
Yeah, I really think it could, because you've got to go today. This racetrack is very tricky. We've always talked about it many, many times. You've got to stay on this race course. You've got to make sure you don't run your car out of fuel and get yourself in a bad way. You can lose a lot of points at this racetrack, and it's a matter of one lap.
Yep, drivers outside the top 10 struggle. All right, DW, which driver can we expect a second-half surge from? Somebody will really take off.
Who's coming on?
I think Jeff Gordon will recover from some of the bad runs he's had, and I think he'll get himself back in the championship picture.
Yeah, you're a pretty smart guy.
Michael Waltrip.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
I did tell you that for 20 years.
Yeah, and don't forget, I think another veteran right now, Dale Jarrett, may be another sleeper, sneak in there for the point championship.
Hey, Mike, he's going to be in the chase, too.
Kyle Busch.
He's my dark horse.
We'll give his official projection prediction.
Long shot.
All right, in 10 seconds, Jeff, who's your pick to win the championship? You're on the clock.
Did it take that long? Jimmy Johnson. I said earlier, okay. And I still believe it.
Oh, that's going out on a limb, huh? Okay.
Sticking with what I said earlier.
Do you want to know what I think?
Real quick. Go ahead.
I'm going to pick Greg Biffle only because of the history of Roush.
Okay.
You had Kenseth. You had the kid last year.
Kurt Busch.
Yeah. That kid.
And no owner has ever won three straight, and certainly Jack Roush would do that if that's the case. All right, last one, DW. What are you going to do with your time off? Jack Roush.
Oh, okay, all right.
What was the question?
What are you going to do with your time off?
I'm going to...
Work on your notes?
I'm going to get my power washer out, and I'm going to start washing my driveway. I love instant gratification. I like that.
All right. We're going to have, that sounds exciting.
You think that's exciting?
For him?
I might even do my neighbor's yard.
All right, you do that. You'll do more commercials. We'll see you in commercials, I'm sure, somewhere.
I figured he'll get some more toolboxes back from his neighbors.
Got to do a little Toyota.
We talked about who we thought would win, Jeff. You did a little formula thing where you're going to give your projection on who's going to make the chase. All right? Tell us how you did this and who's in.
Well, what I did, guys, I took a look at the point standings the first half of the year. And look at what happens here on to Richmond. And based off of what the numbers are showing from 2004 and this year, these are the guys I think are going to make it. The top 12 are going to be in there because they're within the 400 points, like Dale Jarrett, Jeremy Mayfield. But you're going to see Jeff Gordon make a real strong run back. But the guys who are not, Kevin Harvick's going to slip. Dale Earnhardt's not going to get there. Michael, hey, buddy, I know he might be your brother, but he's not going to make it along with Rusty.
No, you got half of them right. Your top half's right. Your bottom half's all off.
All right, so
it's just by the numbers. It's not by the heart.
The Hammond.
Trust that.
Hammond
a lot of things can be said when drivers have heart and want to do things. This is by the numbers.
Man, those are old numbers. I'm looking at the future.
He had Jarrett in and Junior out. Fans, we invite you to participate in the singular virtual crew chief question during the race today. Stay tuned for details on how to play. Watch for your chance to win and drive away in your own singular 31 car. In just a moment, we'll reveal the winner of our NASCAR Sexiest Driver poll. 7 million votes were cast in both the popular vote at Electoral College, a photo finish. People are waiting. The results straight ahead on Fox. Glad you're with us for NASCAR on Fox. That's Boris Jett, one of the ringers, the road course specialist brought in for the race here in Sonoma. Others, Scott Pruitt, Ron Fellows. NASCAR has just two road courses a year, Watkins Glen, and of course, here. Time to name the winner of our immensely popular Sexiest Driver contest. Close to 17 million votes were cast, a record in any contest that didn't feature Simon Cowell. To give the results for this seismic event, we turn to our sexiest expert, NFL on Fox weather forecaster, Jillian Barbary. Take it away, Jillian.
Thanks, Chris. NASCAR's Sexiest Driver. Wow, this contest really turned out to be a huge deal. I mean, we got nearly 17 million votes. Can you believe that? I guess it's true, more women are watching NASCAR than ever before. I know I am. But like all good things, this too must come to an end, sadly. It's time to find out who is NASCAR's sexiest driver. Will it be the fabulous Dale Earnhardt Jr. with his down-home good looks? Dale, I don't want to upset Jeff, but I think you're a shoo-in. I think you're going to win. I may have had a little say since our Budweiser campaign, but don't say anything to him. Or will it be the fabulous California pretty boy, Jeff Gordon? Are you kidding? I so voted for you on the internet. I was like on there all night, day and night. It was ridiculous. I think you're going to win. Don't tell anybody. Well, before I announce the winner, let's take a look back at some of their early matchups. In the first round, Junior had no problem beating Carl Edwards, but that was before his two wins. Even People magazine knows the girls are flipping over Carl now. Tony Stewart gave Dale a little more of a fight, but he couldn't beat him in the end.
Being up against Dale Jr., that's the last guy that you want to get bracketed up against.
And then in the Battle of the Dales with more than 3 million votes, Jr. beat Dale Jarrett by just 0.2%. That's it, just 0.2. He missed him by that much. As for 24, he also had an easy first round against Robbie Gordon. But in the second round, Jamie McMurray and his boy band Good Looks put up a pretty good fight and got 49% of the votes. Last week, Jeff beat Elliott Sadler to face number 8 in the finals. Okay, I know you guys are ready to find out who won, right? So am I. But we're not going to let you know just yet. First, I asked a couple of my hottie friends to tell me who they voted for.
Jeff Gordon is definitely NASCAR's sexiest driver. I mean, anybody that can win 4 championships and be funny on Saturday Night Live is sexiest in my book.
I'm going with Dale Earnhardt Jr. because that boy's a hottie. I saw him on TV at a stripper pole in his basement, a whole little boom boom room thing going on, and he likes hip hop, so I'm going with Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Thanks, ladies. Okay, you guys have waited long enough. It's time to find out who the winner is. Are you ready? Don't we have a drum roll or something? With 51% of more than 7 million votes. That's right, we got 7 million votes this week alone. NASCAR's sexiest driver is Dale Earnhardt Jr. Ooh, look how excited he is. Well, it was close, but Jr. won by just 21,000 votes. All right, now the only question remaining is, who's the sexiest guy at the Hollywood Hotel?
All right. Wow.
I am so not surprised.
You are honored and touched. And so is Dale Earnhardt Jr. He's standing by as Jeff Gordon. We'll talk more with Jeff a little bit later on. Let's check in to Steve Burns. You get to play the role kind of like a Burt Parks, Steve.
Thank you, Chris. It's the highlight of my career. Now, Junior, I know you'd rather be talking about the points lead, but the lovely Lisa presenting you with NASCAR's sexiest driver. 7 million votes alone this week. Congratulations.
Thanks a lot. Yes, I got to thank all the fans who voted, and because I know they voted an awful lot. And my mom, who voted probably 500,000 times this week. So just thanks to all the fans, and you know, it's kind of fun seeing who was winning, who wasn't, but it kind of got personal there in the finals between me and Jeff, so I'm glad I beat him.
Will you take that in the car or leave it in the pits?
No, probably not. This will definitely, I'll let my mom have it, so she probably, I don't know if she voted the most, but... She was up there.
She had a lot to do with it.
Yes, she did.
Good luck today. Dale Earnhardt Jr. starting 10th today.
All right, thanks very much, Steve. And to the fans, thanks a lot for voting and supporting. I mean, it's really...
It's a pretty awesome little event. It really
yeah,
was.
I mean, it showed you the loyalty and the backing of fans behind their drivers and what they...
I just wonder if you were had been in the running, if you would have been okay.
No shot. No.
All right.
Okay.
Don't even go
all right,
there.
This has
all
been
right,
a year of a transition to NASCAR, so we say hello to a new generation of young drivers. We'll never forget two grand old men of the sport who will retire from full-time cup racing after this season. Mark Martin and Rusty Wallace have a combined total of 89 cup wins. Both have won here at Sonoma. On Friday, they were the track's first two inductees into the Wall of Fame in Victory Circle. And as retirement approaches, neither driver slamming on the brakes.
Just a good old boy.
never meaning no harm. Gets the checkered flag, first Winston Cup victory.
Straight in the curve.
The 1989 Winston Cup champion.
Land in the hill.
Wallace's car barrel rolls 7, 8, 9 times.
Take it away. The only way they know how.
Mark and Wallace driving like a couple of kids.
And we're joined by two drivers who have provided racing fans with thrills and spills. An honor to have Rusty Wallace and Mark Martin both with us and together, guys. And thanks. And I want you both to respond to this, too, because, you know, we've heard Michael Jordan, John Elway talk. And I guess, Rusty, we'll start with you. And then, Marco, how did you know it was time? What told you? And is there any chance you'll change your mind to retire?
No, I don't think there's any chance I'm going to change my mind. That's not my plan at all. I think what told me that when it's time to retire is when I just started complaining about the schedule. I got tired of being gone from home all the time. I got in myself complaining about every little thing that bothered me. 36 races, 9 test sessions. And I told myself, you know, if that starts bothering me, then you need to hang it up and do a different thing. But I feel like I'm still competitive. We're running great this year. We're 8th in the points right now and giving it our all. But the thing that really tipped me over definitely was the schedule. That's something I love driving a car, but I get tired of living in a motor coach every single race and being gone from home all the time.
Hey, Mark, go ahead.
Well, it's a whole lot the same as Rusty. You know, the schedule and the demands are incredible. And also, you know, it is really, really difficult to stay at the top of your game all these years. And it was always really important to me to get out of Nextel Cup Racing near the top of my game. And right now with the Viagra team, you know, doing such a great job on my cars, I may be able to call it right at the top. This is really, you know, going good for us this year on the racetrack, and I couldn't be happier.
Hey, Rusty, Marcus, DW. It's got to make you feel good that you're getting the support from your team that you're getting in your final year. You with Roger, Rusty, and Jack with you, Mark. That's got to be a big bond and something that you look forward to carrying on after you retire.
Well, it really is. You know, Roger and I started the team along with Don Miller back in 91, and we won a ton of races. Whether it's with Raymond Beater with the Blue Max team, or that was really fun days back then with the championship in 89, to starting a brand new team with Penske 91, which recently I sold about a month ago to start my new array way of thinking back up. But yeah, I got a great team, and Mark does too, and that's the reason we stuck with these guys this long, because they're awesome people.
Yeah, you know, I couldn't be blessed more. Pat Tryson and everybody on the Jack Roush number 6 team, just incredible. We got almost everyone back from last year on the team. They really want to give me a shot at this championship in my final attempt, and they're doing everything that they can. And just to see the look on their face after we won the All-Star race, you know, was just priceless. I mean, that's what it's all about. That's why we work so hard, and that's why we do all this stuff, is for a little payoff like that.
Well, now, guys, a lot of the people at home don't know this for sure. I know what you're going to do, but, Mark, what are you going to do when you do quit driving for the Nextel Cup Series? And same for you, Rusty.
Well, I'm going to drive one of Jack Roush's trucks on the Craftsman Truck Series full-time, and going to run the All-Star race. Of course, I committed to that before I got the car back to the pit road after that race and the Bud Shootout. And there's a possibility of doing some Busch races. But, you know, from now on, I'm going to put my family first and having fun right next to that. And that's really important to me.
Yeah, I guess I've got to say the same thing. Having fun is a real important thing that I haven't done in a long time. It's always work, 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 stay flying, stay going, stay moving, all taking care of sponsors, which I love to do. But I want to have some fun. You know, I want to take care of all my car dealerships set up in East Tennessee. I want to do some television work. One of the main things I want to do is take care of my son Steven's race career, try to get him going. My son Greg is doing great in college, and Katie and everybody. It's time for me just to kind of come back home and spend some time with the most important things in life, and that's my family, and definitely stay with Team Penske. You know, I'm going to be a busy guy. There's no doubt about that. I got a lot of things I just mentioned, but it's about time to get the priorities straightened back out. I've worked my whole life to make a career and make some money, and we've done that. Now it's time to throttle back a little bit and put some quality instead of quantity.
Okay, guys, we got something that we want to give you. You both meant so much to the sport.
Oh, man.
You mean so much to us. And just a little, you know, Earnhardt gave me a rocking chair in 2000. I said, what am I going to do with this? And you'll come to find out it's something that you won't.
Go ahead, Rusty, hop in.
Can I try it out?
Yeah, sit down there and
I want to see what it's like.
They're sturdy. Don't worry.
Oh, I tell you, this thing handles pretty good.
Hey, Rusty, you will cherish that the rest of your life.
Well, I got it set up right now where I turn left and right. What about you, Mark?
This is what I'm going to do next year on Sunday. Watch these races and rock in this chair.
Yeah, baby, yeah.
Right.
Get a little
tell you what, man, if I get behind during the race, I'm going to get my pitcher guys to throw this baby out in front of the leader.
All right. Hey, thank you both. I know the fans feel the same way. We at Fox for making our coverage and having you along for the races. It's been a lot of fun. We appreciate it very much.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Yeah. Thank you, good luck, guys.
Thank you.
The rest of the season as well as whatever they enjoy in retirement. But they'll be busy. And I like it. They both say, I want to have fun. They devoted a lot of their lives to the sport. Now they want to devote it to their family.
People just don't realize how much time you have to commit to be successful in this sport.
That's right.
You got to stay in shape. You got to do appearances. And you got to race. And there's no time for anything else.
All right, when we come back, NASCAR and Fox continuing from Sonoma. We'll talk with Jeff Gordon about his grassroots approach to racing and his wine business. And we'll rock on with Mark and Rusty. You'll see them in action later today. It's NASCAR on Fox.
They look good there, don't they?
Yeah.
Yeah, they do.
Yeah. Don't get mad.
It's time to get this show on the road.
Yeah.
Road course, that is.
Oh, yeah.
11 turns, 110 laps, 1,320 ships, and you cannot mess up any of them.
California! California!
Greg Biffle is number one here. He has 5 wins this year. As we welcome you back to NASCAR on Fox and Finian Raceway in Sonoma, the heart of wine country. With 8 victories in 15 races, the dominant team in 2005 belongs to Jack Roush, known as the Cat in the Hat. Californians, they like a good nickname, like Magic, Shaq, and the Terminator. This year, the Jack attack has been relentless. With Dick Bergman, one of those Roush racers. Dick?
No, I'm with the Biff, the guy who has won more races this year than anybody else. He was on a potential pole-winning run here at Infineon when he got off course. As a result, you're going to start so deep in the field, 41st. Can a guy win from this deep in the field?
I don't know. I hope so. We're definitely going to try. You know, we got a great car here, National Guard posted car. Did real well in both practices. So just driver error qualifying, got off the racetrack, and we'll just work our way to the front. You know, just do what we can to get track position. Maybe, you know, pit strategy is big here. You know, stop early, fuel, tires. You know, be the first guy to stop on the last stop. So all kinds of things can happen for us for track position. But just keep our head on straight and try and get up front. Stay on the track today.
Well, the furthest back anyone has started and won the race is 13th, so Biffle surely has his work cut out for him. Chris?
All right, thanks, Dick. And of course, throughout the year, we've joked, Dick, about his age as our senior reporter, Dr. Dirt, and he's a good sport. All kidding aside, he's done a great job, and we kid because we care. Dick knows that. Okay, how about if Roush is so dominant, you pick Biff to be the champ, right?
No.
Are other people, Jeff, maybe going to copy what they're doing, or can they? What are they doing differently? How have they gotten the edge?
How they gotten their edge is their drivers. I mean, when you think about this whole stable of drivers, as far as Greg Biffle, Matt Kenseth, Kurt Busch, Carl Edwards, I mean, all these guys are so talented. Matt Kenseth right now is the only guy struggling in the Roush camp, but he, too, could just turn it around in a matter of one race. It's this talent behind the wheel.
And what about starting from back of the pack?
Well, a few years ago, Ernie Irvin started on the pole here. He got black flag for jumping the start. He had to go to the rear, and he came from the rear to the front to win. So it can be done.
Furthest back of drivers won a race this year, 29th. Carl Edwards, one of the Roush drivers. Right behind Greg Biffle, his 5 wins. Jeff Gordon with 3 for the most this season. But in 4 of the last 5 races, Gordon has finished 30th or worse. He's not whining about it. Well, actually, he's whining a little because he's about to market a brand of upscale wines that'll be part of the Jeff Gordon collection. Jeff told me while he hopes to zero in on a 5th points championship, there is time to stop and smell the rosé.
I love wine. I mean, I definitely have an appreciation for wine, especially good wine, and I feel like I have a pretty good knowledge of what a good wine is.
So is it a transition for NASCAR? I mean, you think of it traditionally as a beer drinker's sport.
You know, we come out here to Sonoma area and we race out here and we're in the wine country. And I think a lot of us within the sport enjoy wine. And I think, you know, fans as well enjoy wine. My love for wine and my interest in getting involved in making wine really isn't trying to target NASCAR or NASCAR fans. It's just a passion that I have.
Set yourself up with wine and, you know, people who are complaining, right? Oh. You'll hear that.
Hey, I'm a whiner, so I might as well be drinking it as well.
There you go. This season, if you think about it lately, it's been kind of a sour grapes time of year for you. You think we'll see another vintage Jeff Gordon year this season?
Well, there's been too many sour grapes here lately, but we're hoping with the Jeff Gordon collection of wine, we're going to have some great grapes come out of that, and hopefully this weekend at the racetrack, we're going to, you know, get things turned around for us.
Don't you think it's been a strange kind of a first 15 races?
It has, and you know, every year there's something new that's thrown at you. You never know how things are going to go. Sometimes things are just smooth. It doesn't seem like things can go wrong. And there's times when you know, like we start off the season, Daytona 500 victory.
Daytona 500! I'm so proud of you guys.
They're like, yeah, man, this is going to be a great year. And then some things happen.
That's the dumbest thing I've ever done in my life.
And you go, okay, you know, that's a wake-up call to know that you just got to dig every single weekend, no matter what the results are.
You think your fans are worried that Jeff Gordon might miss out on the chase for the Nextel Cup?
Yeah, you know, we're definitely concerned. I mean, we're, you know, over 400 out. We're outside the top 10. We've had some rough weeks. But I think that if any team is capable of pulling things together when it really needs to happen, it's our race team.
And it would seem unheard of that both Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Jeff Gordon would not be in the chase, right?
I mean, yeah, I wonder if they'd start changing things then.
How's the personal life, the social life for Jeff Gordon
these days? You always got to ask that question.
Yeah, that's important.
Okay, everybody wants
tabloid
to know.
Tabloid material. Oh, I'm hoping you're giving something good.
Right. No, I have nothing good. I mean, yes, I have something good in my life. But I'm happy. You know, I've got a great girl. Things are good. I'm happy.
You're going to be 34 in August, young by most standards. Where is that in racing years? And do you feel the passion to race till you're 40, another 5 years?
I try not to ever put a time limit on. But I will say that, you know, to me, it's not about age. It's about when, you know, I'm either not having fun, not competitive. You know, those are the things that drive me, keep me wanting to go. And I don't know how long that's going to be.
The Jeff Gordon Wine Collection, the August Briggs Winery 2004 Chardonnay will be available in October. That'll be followed by a Merlot.
Yes, and in the past, you know, drivers would have wine for dinner. Now these drivers have wine with dinner.
It's a little bit different face. All right, now, why is Jeff? What's the matter?
I'm just thinking right there. Jeff said he was a whiner,
yeah,
but he was hanging out with a wino.
Oh, stop.
Oh, yeah, okay.
All right.
I'm sorry.
Why is he so dominant? I'll do the jokes. You just analyze things. No, why is he so dominant on the road course, his best of all time in terms of and success here with four wins at Infineon Raceway?
He has confidence. He has finesse. He has the ability, I think, to look further down the road than a lot of drivers that understand how to drive road race courses. Jimmy Johnson told me today that he's helped him tremendously to realize that you don't drive a course off the end of the hood. You got to look way ahead.
All right. You mentioned Jimmy Johnson, Jeff Gordon's teammate. He's been in first place in the point standings the last 12 races. Look, Greg Biffle, Carl Edwards, Rusty Wallace, Kevin Harvick, and Jimmy McMurray, they were not in the chase last year, but currently they would all qualify. Earlier we saw Jeff's projection or prediction on who might get in. You see where Jeff Gordon is out currently, Dale Jarrett is out, Michael Waltrip, and of course Dale Earnhardt Jr. Well, let's talk with the points leader, and our Steve Burns is with us. Steve?
Thanks, Chris. Now, Jimmy, I know you're focused on this race. You got a great starting position, but this is our last race on Fox. When we see you next time, will you be the reigning champion?
Well, I hope so, but there's a lot of other guys that want to be that person as well. So we'll see. Things are good, and thanks to Fox for all the fun that we've had. And I look forward to a great day today. This Lowe's Monte Carlo has been really strong. I've been doing my job. I made it back in qualifying my first time in 3 years, and I got a good spot out of it. So looking forward to a good day today.
Last year, you started at the rear, finished fifth. You said that felt like a victory. Your confidence even better today?
Without a doubt. And I'm up here in great company. I've got Jeff Gordon in front of me, Mark Martin, Boris Said, a lot of really good road course racers. To where I know when we're racing, they're going to make safe, smart moves. I can learn stuff being around them and racing with them. So I'm looking forward to a really good, clean, smart day.
Best of luck today and the rest of 2005. We appreciate it, Jimmy.
Yeah, thank you so much.
All right, let's go back to Chris Myers.
All right, thank you, Steve. And all right, so Biffle and Jimmy Johnson, should they conserve a little bit as we get to the chase for the points since they have the wins?
Well, I think Jimmy Johnson, you know, he lost last year. And they say you got to lose one to win one. But I think what's going to propel Biffle to the championship is his aggression. He's got to control it, but when he gets behind, he can come back and win a race and catch back up.
But the thing is right now, what Jimmy Johnson understands that Biffle doesn't right now is consistency. I think they got the consistency factor working for him, so when the pressure does come on, he'll still be consistent.
But remember how Johnson got back in the chase last year in the final 10. He won half of the races.
Yeah. All right, worth watching here. Greg Biffle has led the most laps this season, 953. Dale Earnhardt Jr. has only led 5 laps. Dale Jarrett, Jamie McMurray, they've each led only 1 lap. On this, our final show of the season, we had to go one more lap and bring back some of the best answers from 10 laps with.
Which celebrity would you most like to meet?
Pamela Anderson.
Well, that's a good one.
I already did, so I better not say that.
Who's the funniest driver?
I think it's got to be probably Kenny Wallace. I always see him laughing, and you always hear him laughing somewhere.
Yeah, that's a recognizable laugh.
Yes, you know it's Kenny.
Who's the best dressed driver? Rusty Wallace.
I'll say Rusty Wallace.
Okay.
The guy always has his stuff ironed. And he's always on me about tucking my shirt in and ironing my my pants, so he's always dressed right.
Night racing.
Awesome.
Love it.
Awesome. A lot of fun. Marriage.
Scared.
Good. It does have a lot of that in it. You're right.
Darrell Waltrip.
Great driver.
Why aren't you answering?
Kind of a hero.
I'm choosing my words. I could have blurted some things out.
Or one word.
Yeah, I'm not going to do that.
In one word, I guess.
Okay, funny.
Junior.
Cheeseburger.
Chris Myers.
Goofball.
Now, wait a minute. That's no way to end this thing.
Let me see your notes.
Can't you come up with something better than that?
Well, Scott.
I'm just moving through. All right, that was fun. Right, thanks.
It was fun.
Yeah, no move through.
I felt like you were my therapist.
Just, yeah. That laugh will send you to therapy.
Hey, wait a minute. Chris Myers.
Goofball.
Okay. Right.
You gave Harvick that. I know. Yeah, because Harvick couldn't think of that on his own. All right. It's been fun, believe it or not, working with you guys. And once again, it's kind of weird to kind of hand off after this many races. We have a big race today. You'll be up in the booth with Mike and Larry and for our pit crew and all the production crew. We always appreciate their hard work as we kind of wrap things up at the midpoint here of the season.
But the thing is right now, Chris, more importantly, I think what I'm going to miss the fans. They've been so great this year so far.
I'm going to miss the drivers. I think this is the most fun group of drivers that's been in NASCAR in years. Their personalities, their passion, their ability, and their willingness to cooperate with us and do weird things. I love the drivers. My guys.
Can we do it next year?
Yeah, we'll be back next year.
All right.
Yeah, we'll be around.
I love my team, too. I love my Fox team.
All right. The Seahawks are coming. That's later. All right. Actually, it's NASCAR on Fox from Sonoma. In a moment, we'll count you down to the race.
Three times each year, NASCAR comes to California, but only in June do they come north of San Francisco and visit wine country. Napa and Sonoma Valleys, home to great California wines, and this course, Infineon Raceway, built upon Sears Point just south of Sonoma, site of great road racing action. Welcome to the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series on Fox, where today America's best will tackle the twisting, turning road course here in Sonoma. Let's go trackside.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, if you would please, rise for the presentation of colors by the Travis Air Force Base Honor Guard from Fairfield, California. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if you would please remove your hats and remain standing as we prepare for our invocation. From Raceway Ministries, Miss Tina Coleman.
Please pray with me. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come out for the Dodge Save Mart 350. Thank you for the Infineon staff, volunteers, the official safety crew and medical personnel who make this event possible. Thank you for the skill and the dedication of the drivers and their crews that we are privileged to watch. And thank you for these enthusiastic fans. We ask you now for your protection and guidance over each one, keeping us safe during the event, and as we leave here, full of the excitement that is NASCAR. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Thanks, Miss Tina. And now, ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem as performed by Mr. Eric Lewis. A-10A Thunderbolt II aircraft, four-ship from the 355th Wing from Davis-Montham Air Force Base in Arizona.
I guess we had to go back to the only one that worked for us, so far, Chip's ass.
The drivers strap in, the crews gather for a moment of reflection and focus. As we near the midpoint in this 2005 season, let's have a look at the Nextel Cup standings. With Jimmy Johnson continuing to lead, though Greg Biffle's win last week cut the margin to 49. Kevin Harvick anchors the top 10. And the magic 400-point mark that would put a driver into the chase for the Nextel Cup. Jamie McMurray, the last eligible driver. Jeff Gordon, Mayfield, Waltrip, Jared Burton, Earnhardt Jr., and the remainder out of the running right now. So we come to Sonoma. Larry McReynolds, I'm Mike Joy. Darrell will join us shortly to call this race. And Larry, this is a track where some drivers come in here thinking this is a great opportunity to pick up some points because they're confident, accomplished road racers. And other drivers come here knowing that if they can just keep two tires on the track all day long, they can come out of here without losing a whole lot of points. So we've got a lot of different agendas here.
I mean, if you looked at the points right there, third through eighth is separated by less than 100 points. Yeah, everyone comes out here wanting to win this race. But you know, if you can walk out of here with a top 10 finish, that you've had a pretty good day. We've got two different ends of the spectrum. We have the man leading the points, Jimmy Johnson, starting on the front row. We have the man second and third in points, Greg Biffle and Elliott Sadler, starting almost tail end Charlie. So those boys, they've got some work to do today because this race is only 110 laps.
But wait, there's more, as they say. The road course ringers, the drivers who are not Nextel Cup regulars but who have lots of winning road race experience, there's a bunch of them sprinkled in this field as well. So it's going to be an entertaining run around this 11-turn road race course, and it's coming at you next right here on Fox. Welcome back to Infineon Raceway in Sonoma, California, as Joe Nemechek gets ready to race. Ricky Rudd, winner of the first NASCAR race here. The Budweiser Bowl Award, given to the fastest qualifier at each NASCAR Nextel Cup Series race by Budweiser, official beer of NASCAR. Budweiser congratulates Jeff Gordon on his second Bud Bowl this season. Here are the drivers he will join in the Budweiser Shootout of 2006.
Here is the starting lineup for today's Dodge Save Mart 300 with Hendrick Motorsports teammates filling the front row. There's Jeff Gordon getting ready. He and Jimmy Johnson up front. Mark Martin and one of those road course ringers, Boris Said, row two. Another one and a past winner here, Robbie Gordon. Last year's champion, Kurt Busch. Tony Stewart has won here, and so has Terry Labonte. So this will get really interesting. Let's go trackside for the command.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is time for the words we've been waiting to hear. First of all, from Northern California Dodge dealers and our Grand Marshal, Larry the Cable Guy.
Gentlemen, get her done and start your engines.
Three drivers at the ready. It's a Hercules HC-130. It's part of our flyover this afternoon. Let's get some late-breaking stories from pit road, beginning with Matt Yocum.
Mike, for the second time this season, owner Rick Hendrick has two of his Chevrolets in the front row, but his two teams with slightly different agendas coming into the Infineon Raceway. Jeff Gordon, he's just trying to stop the bleeding in the championship chase. The last five races, he's fallen from third to 12th, and he's currently out of the chase. He can't be too aggressive, can't take a hit in the points like Rusty Wallace did on the final lap here 1 year ago. Went from fourth to 28th, losing 80-some points. He's got to play it aggressive, but not too aggressive. His teammate, Jimmy Johnson, he's just hoping to maintain, but he knows the guy who's second in the points is well deep in the field. Biffle starting 41st. Anyway, he, too, would love to pick up his first road course victory, but they both told me, on the front row, whoever gets a turn first, we'll get the lead. They're not going to battle to see who gets to turn one first. To Steve Burns.
Well, Matt, you said it. Greg Biffle, second in points. He starts deep in the field, 41st. I talked to his crew chief, Doug Richard, this morning. I said, what can you do to get track position, which is so essential here on the road course? He said, what we're hoping for is to get an early caution about lap 7 or 8. We'll pit. Everybody else will stay out. Then when they have to pit, we will stay out and have that track position. I said, Doug, what if that doesn't happen? He said, then it's entirely up to Greg Biffle. He's going to have to pick them off one at a time. To the executive editor of Speedway Illustrated magazine, Dick Berggren.
They are called ringers, drivers who spend their entire racing season on road courses. And twice a year, they come to the NASCAR Dextel Cup Series to do battle with the Dextel Cup regulars. Ron Fellows, Scott Pruitt have both finished as high as second in the Dextel Cup Series. Could win today? Could we see a ringer beat the regulars, the veterans in this series? Boris Said, right behind me, car number 36. He's got the best starting position of any of the seven. He will roll off fourth. And just moments ago, I asked him, who among the seven has the best chance to win today? He looked at me, smiled, and said, I do. Said claimed he has the best car he's ever had here and the best crew he's ever had here. He may be the ringer that takes home the trophy, Mike.
There's a good chance of that, Dick. There they are, the seven drivers who we consider road course ringers. P.J. Jones, a late replacement in the number four car, trying to keep that up in the top 35 in owner points. And maybe add Terry Labonte to that list. He's won here, and he's no longer an Xtel Cup regular, so Terry could be a ringer as well. Here's our first singular crew chief question of the day. Greg Biffle's been eating away at Jimmy Johnson's point lead. Will we leave Sonoma with a new Cup points leader? To vote, text the word crew to 191 on your singular wireless phone or go to foxsports.com. You'll also be entered for a chance to drive away in your own singular number 31 car. In Northern California, the big question is not stickers or scuffs, it's red wine or white. as we're in Sonoma, California, on what's going to turn out to be a beautiful day. It was very cool here in the morning. There has been a very low overcast, heavy cloud, so the air temperature is only 63, but the sun has been beating through, and it's got the track up to almost 100 degrees. 11 turns around this course. You see the cars in the S's. Boris Said's going to take us for a lap around, but first, Darrell, your take on Infineon Raceway.
One of the unique things about this racetrack, Mike, is the elevation changes. Here we're going uphill to turn one. Now we're coming around turn three, and we're going to make a really hard run downhill to turn four. Tight right-hander across to another tight right-hander. Now we're coming through the S's really fast, turn 10, and really slow off of turn 11. Got to get the power down. Now watch these three boxes. Watch Boyce Said's feet. He's looking out the windshield. Watch how he uses his right foot.
He's off the gas, third gear up the hill, back to second gear, into turn two, reel off camber, reel blind, just got to ease into gas, don't spin the tires, off the hill, make through 3-8, over the hill, blind, looking for your mark, just ease back into gas, really just spin the tires here, downhill, off the brake, use all the road here, over the curve.
Sure, there's one point coming to turn two. I saw him hitting all three pedals at once, and of course, with only 2 feet. There is a look at Infineon Raceway. 11 corners here as we get set to go racing in California wine country. Darrell joins us, and boy, Boris made it look easy.
Yeah, well, I just wanted the fans at home to see that heel and toe thing. We talk about it a lot. Toes on the brakes, heel over on the gas. That's what separates a really good road racer from a guy that uses both feet. Notice he only uses the clutch when he's downshifting, not when he's upshifting. So finesse, that's the key.
And are these cars a lot easier or a little easier to drive than when you raced here?
Oh, I think they're somewhat easier because of the equipment. Better transmissions, better brakes, better tires. Just everything's better. So it makes it a little easier. But Ron Fellow said these cars are harder to drive than the Corvette that he races on a regular basis.
Sure, they're much heavier and they have a lot less tire width, so yeah, I'd agree. Larry, crew chief's keys to success today.
Well, there's three of them. You can't have mechanical failures. Now, you can't control a lot of that, but a lot of them you can, because really can overwork the brakes here, and with that driver shifting over a dozen times a lap, can't miss a shift, you'll have transmission failure. Stay on the racetrack. I don't know how many times late in the race we see drivers in our position, maybe for not a win, but a good top five or top 10, get off the racetrack and not even finish in the top 25. You heard Steve Burns talk about Doug Richard, Greg Biffle's crew chief. Good strategy on, I mean, two pit stops. Get in there by lap 30, lap 70, and then pack your stuff up, because you don't need to be back on pit road more than twice.
Thanks, Larry. Getting set to go here at Infineon Raceway. Let's get out of the Ford Cutaway car. Chris and Jim.
Thanks, Mike. And guys at Hammond's Outdoor Garage, with his parts all over the place, we heard Larry's keys. Jeff has boiled it down to the single most important factor for a driver having success today. What would that be?
I think right here is the key, this transmission. You've got to take care of this today. More importantly, because you lose the gear, you're not going to be able to go very fast. People are going to be passing you. If you tear this thing up, you easily could tear gear out and wind it spinning off the racetrack and crashing.
How does a driver take care of that and still be aggressive?
You've got to be finesseful. You got to make sure you don't try to use the transmission for brakes. You brake first, then you downshift nice and smooth, making sure that this piece of equipment doesn't get damaged, because it is the key to success today.
In theory, only a couple of pit stops, so it's not so much how many, though, it's when we see them today.
That's right. A lot of times you want to worry about how quick you can beat people off of pit road. Today, you want to beat people to pit road, and the number of times you want to do it is just two.
From the Ford Cutaway car, now let's go over to Dick Bergman. Dick?
Well, Dale Earnhardt Jr. has won the poll as NASCAR's sexiest driver. Other than that, it has been an ugly season. 17th in points, that's all you really need to say about it. A junior doesn't have a reputation as a great road racer, but maybe he should have. As a Busch Series competitor, he won at Watkins Glen. The last 2 years at Watkins Glen, he has finished third and fifth. And yesterday when he got out of his race car, after the final practice, Junior had a big beaming smile on his face. He was fourth quick. He will start in the 10th position today, and who knows, this may be the track where he breaks out and finally gets his first win of the year. To Matt Yoakum.
Dick, about 50 minutes ago, the Professor Bohr said, was joking around and critiquing the spins this weekend of both Greg Biffle and Elliott Sadler together. And, you know, when you talk about the strategy of Biffle, you've already heard what that team was looking at doing. Now, Elliott Sadler's is very similar. He said that he and Todd Pirrett, they're going to have to try something different. Maybe pit for two tires. Try to pass more cars on pit road, because it'll be very difficult on the racetrack. And he also told me one other thing that he learned his very first start here. He said, I didn't pass a car all day long on the racetrack, but I kept it on the racetrack, and I scored a top 15 finish. That's what we have to go for today, the bigger picture. Steve?
All right, thanks, Matt. Kurt Busch, the defending Nextel Cup champion, starts in a nice place, sixth. But it's a bit of strategy here by crew chief Jimmy Fenech that has this team excited. Now, behind me there, turn 11, you'll see a lot of passing there. But it's pit stall 43 where they will stop, which means they have the first pit, a clear shot onto pit road, and they should have a clear shot off of pit road. And I believe Jeff Gordon won a race from pit stall number 43. Mike?
Thanks, Steve. The light is off atop the Dodge Charger pace car. They'll go 110 laps to run 219 miles, 350 kilometers here. 35 on pit road, and they'll need to stop twice.
We'll be talking about that a lot today, I promise you.
And Biffle's got a good pit. That's not a bad pit stall to have, first one in.
Aerial coverage provided by Goodyear as they come through turn 10. Very fast corner here, not a lot of radius, but you're carrying so much speed coming down there. Easy corner to misjudge.
Oh, yeah, you'll see cars run off on turn 10. It's a lot of speed through the S's. Hard to make that corner and carry speed.
And that's where Greg Biffle and Elliott Sadler had their problems in qualifying on Friday.
Then to turn 11. If you think Martinsville is shaped like a paperclip, look at this.
I think that's why Jeff Gordon runs so good here. This place reminds me of Martinsville just 11 times.
Well, DW, the final time, 2005, NASCAR on Fox. Reach up there and pull those belts tight. One more time, let's get this road course party started.
Boogity, 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 boys. Let's go road racing.
A little bit of a ragged start, but they all got caught back up by turn two.
A lot of times you can get run over right there getting to the top of the hill because everybody's bottlenecks.
Yeah, turn one and two right there, the most critical corners of this race, because you want to make it through there and hopefully everyone gets spread out a little bit.
Turns three and 3A.
This track really wasn't meant to be raced on side by side.
Come on. Sure it was, just not for 110 straight laps.
That's exactly right.
I'm sure we'll get to see it again. I think Scott Riggs in the 10 car already has a lot of damage on the rear of his car up there, I'm sure, in turn one and two.
Happens every time here. You get up there, you're going, and everybody's stopping.
Now, this is the S's that we always talk about.
Boy, just got off right there.
And he's got Kurt Busch alongside, Boris said. Here's Scott Pruitt pulling up on Sed, gets right to his bumper. And may try to outbreak him into 11. Oh, three wide.
Boys, it won't work.
Well, that's two guys right there that are, you know, for bragging rights.
Pruitt gets the spot.
Boris got off over here in the S's, and it's cost him a lot of momentum, and that's how come Pruitt got by him.
So Scott Pruitt moves up to seventh in that white Haviland Dodge. At 11 today, remember, that's Terry Labonte, as Brian Vickers is already on pit road. Cut a tire. And you can see damage to the right front.
I think he's got sheet metal damage.
Yep. Which is what cut the tire, Steve?
Roger.
Yeah, Mike, tire rub on the right front on the first lap for Brian Vickers. They're going to put some bare bond adhesive on it. They've also got a spare nose that they may see about putting on. So trouble for Brian Vickers early.
And with it taking about a minute and 18 seconds to get around this racetrack, the hope is they can get that repaired, maybe get back out there before our leader Jeff Gordon puts them a lap down.
And they're going to an awful lot of trouble on a road course to put a piece of a nose back on the car. Man, let him go.
I want to cut stuff off.
Yeah, that's, get some air in there, baby. What are you thinking?
Mark Martin, a solid third. Tony Stewart, fourth. Robbie Gordon, a past winner here in fifth. The racy-looking guys right now are Kurt Busch and there's Scott Pruitt.
Pruitt's looking really good. Just saw the 10 car go by there of Scott Riggs with quite a bit of rear damage.
And remember Scott Pruitt in that 39 car, he did finish third here a year ago. Felt like he had a car that could beat Jeff Gordon. Team order, stay behind your teammate, Jamie McMurray, who finished second.
Now that's the fourth Chip Ganassi car. And I visited with Chip this morning in the garage. Dan Davis from Ford came over, needed him just a little bit, and he's, you know, Davis, he likes Ford's position this year. He says, Chip, not like when you've been the dominator out here.
Oh, Dale Jr.'s around into the barriers.
Oh, no.
Dale Jr. and a whole bunch of cars are wrecking behind him.
Full course caution is out.
Let's go to the garage, guys. Let's go to the garage.
Jeff Green involved.
Jr. just was coming by the start-finish line here around turn one and lost it.
Great qualifying effort, started 10th. He was in the top 10 in both practice sessions yesterday. Felt good about this race.
I just almost wonder, Larry, I saw it go around so quickly, if he didn't cut a right rear tire down.
See a lot of damage to the right front of Jeff Green, the 43 car.
Does that right rear tire look flat?
It does. Let's see.
Here he comes.
Battling Mike Bliss.
Oh, he and Bliss get together. And that did cut his right rear down.
That probably did cut the tire down.
Right.
Remember, these tires do not run that inner liner. When you cut one down, you're on the rim.
Yep. That's exactly what happened.
We'll see from another angle now. It looks like, I don't see it on this one, but Junior, wow, up and in the wall.
Well, what happened was he just didn't know Bliss was out there. It happened so many times off 11. A guy will get a run up on the inside, and you won't know he's there.
And, Daryl, that happened right here in front of our booth. The spotters are up on the mountain behind us. Probably couldn't see this area.
Ron Fellows checks up and spins.
Full course caution. Got a three-car wreck.
You'll see here that the zero is all the way to the outside of the racetrack, right up against the wall, trying to avoid contact.
He just doesn't know he's there. Mike Bliss on the outside in the zero car. Junior doesn't know he's there. They make contact. Cuts down Junior's right rear tire into the barrier.
And then we saw the onboard from Fellows where he checked up and then spun his car to avoid contact. So there he is. Could anything have gone worse with Dale Jr.'s season so far? He is okay. They'll haul it back to the garage and see what they can do.
Four laps in here at Sonoma. Jeff Gordon leading Jimmy Johnson up front. Here's the response on our virtual crew chief question. As you joined us here on Singular, will we have a new points leader after today's race? Those of you who voted close, but 51% of you said that Jimmy Johnson will hold Greg Biffle off. Of course, Biffle back of the pack, Jimmy up front in this road course. Tough to come from the back of the pack. Time for a Visa race break from the Hollywood Hotel, along with Jeff Hammond, Chris Myers. Glad to have you with us for NASCAR on Fox from the wine country. Early observation, we talked quite a bit about Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s frustration and things like that. We saw a little bit of that here. Of course, this was the track. It wasn't a cup race, but where he was burned last year when he ran here.
Not very good memories when you think about coming back to Infineon, but this team had worked so hard during the course of the week. Steve Mill, the crew chief, said, I believe we got a good race car here, and we're going to have a good finish. But you can see early problems right now. They got the car torn up, and now they're going back. So I'm not surprised that this is kind of like going away. But, hey, look, this is a 16 car. You know, we talked earlier that they may wind up coming in and trying to get a little bit out of sequence with everybody else. You can see they're going to put on four tires, it looks like, fill up with fuel. This will allow him to go a little bit further and put himself on a different pitch strategy. It's exactly what Doug Richard, the crew chief, wanted to see happen.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. hoping to bounce back. This is one of the few race tracks, only two, that he has not had a top 10 finish off to a rocky start for him. Meanwhile, for Jeff Gordon, so far, so good. This has been a Visa race break. We'll continue from Sonoma, California, as we check in now with Steve Burns.
Thanks, Chris. With Dale Earnhardt Jr. just out of the medical center. Dale, did I hear you were having transmission problems before that incident?
Yeah, I didn't have first or second gear from the first lap, and we trying a new transmission here this weekend, and it hadn't given me no troubles at all weekend, and right from the first corner, I mean, it was no second gear. I couldn't get into second, and then it just tore it all out.
Can you get back in the race, Dale?
I'm going to try. You know, I'm just irritated. I mean, we had a good car, you know, and the old transmission was pretty dang good, so I don't know why it wasn't in there to start with.
Chris?
All right, thanks, Steve. So the frustration from Dale Earnhardt Jr., and Jeff, it looked like a tire once he...
Yeah, he got together with Mike Bliss right there, coming toward the start finish line, the right rear tire. As he started up the hill, the car just spun around. And as he said earlier, though, his day was already getting off to a rough start anyway.
Tough road to hoe from the road course will continue. You're watching NASCAR on Fox.
Getting set for the restart, pace car pulls off. At the start of the race, Kevin Harvick had to go to the rear for an engine change. The number four for the driver change, P.J. Jones aboard. And a pit stop on the pace lap for Casey Mears. So they've had to come from the back of the pack and not their qualifying position.
A lot of cars had damage on them, Mike, from that first, going up the hill there on the first lap. Several cars. I noticed Michael and the 10 and others.
Well, I tell you, that time in turn one, Tony Stewart, the 20 car, he was wearing the rear bumper of Jimmy Johnson in that 48 car out up there at turn one.
I think if you just watch that 24 car, though, time and time again that we've been here, he just drives off the lead most everybody. Whoa, look out there.
Robbie Gordon in the 7 car using all the racetrack.
That's the car that might be able to give Jeff Gordon a run for his money, is that 7 car when he gets up there.
And I just believe, you know, we talk about dark horses, not to say Robbie Gordon's a dark horse, but based on his equipment failures this year, if his equipment will stay under him today, I think he will be a contender, that 7 car.
I agree with you, Larry. He is coming.
Yeah, no question. He's a past winner here. As the leaders get to turn 10, and Gordon is up to fourth. Stewart going after Johnson for second, ducks to the inside into turn 11, makes the pass.
Got him.
And I think Jimmy Johnson, the 48, our points leader, knows it's way too early to push the envelope here if Tony caught him like that.
Well, Smoke was quick in practice yesterday. Everybody says he's got the car to beat. So let him go and see what he can do.
Now, Greg Biffle made a pit stop under that caution. We'll let the field cycle through here and show you where Biffle is in 36th place after pit stops on a winding road course where it is very difficult to pass, and I'm trying to stretch this sentence out until he gets there, and I'm not going to make it. Where is he?
There he is.
There he goes.
About 15 seconds behind leader Jeff Gordon.
Let's go to his pit. Here's Matt.
Mike, not a scheduled pit stop. Now, I told you during the pre-race they were going to try to play a little bit different pit strategy. What happened when Dale Earnhardt Jr. wrecked? He flat spotted his left front tire. You can see it all the way down to the cord, so they pitted on lap 4. No changes for the bit, but he did restart near the back in 36th.
Well, he's about made his way back up to where he was, because remember, he started right with Elliott Sadler, the 38 M&M's car. Now he's pulled back up to the rear bumper of Elliott Sadler.
I think I saw a sign on his dash, take no prisoners.
Ooh, Darrell, I don't know if that's the way to race here. We'll see.
Two Robbie ways
Gordon
to go.
In that 7 car, he goes by Jimmy Johnson in the 48. He takes over the third position.
You can throw it around here, or you can finesse it around here. I imagine he's throwing his right now.
Riding with Ricky Rudd, the 21 car, started back in the 20th position.
That's Kenny Schrader just ahead. They cross the stripe.
Really, let's do it on this side.
Ricky knows, back to my keys to winning the race here, is you've got to stay on the racetrack. You have to stay pointed in the right direction and show some patience.
The take no prisoner drivers are the most fun to watch here at Sonoma, but the finesse drivers are the ones who are likely to be standing in victory lane. You saw Scott Riggs, the Valvoline Chevy, a lot of left side sheet metal damage there. And when you have double foul starts here, where track position is so important, you're going to get a good bit of that in the first lap or two.
And that's the good thing about it. That's the only double file start you have as the start of the race. All other restarts at a road course are single file.
That's why track position is so key and critical.
Yeah, I mean, you get bottled up back there. Jeff Gordon, our leader right now, is running a minute 17 and a half seconds. We talked about Greg Biffle, even with those fresh tires, almost a minute 19 seconds. So you just get bottled up back there.
Well, it takes so much focus just to drive your car. And then you put somebody in front of you, and it distracts you, and that's how you get messed up.
See, Bobby Labonte in the 18 car, he's in the 26th position. This is a backup car. Now, he did not have to go to the rear of the field because he crashed in practice before qualifying. Kind of had a rough weekend here, but they got that car pretty good in practice yesterday.
And he is a finesse driver on the super speedways and on the road courses where he's had success as well.
Looks like Stewart is slowly reeling in the 24 car of Jeff Gordon.
Yeah, I've watched the lap time since Tony went by Jimmy Johnson in the 48, and he's almost mirrored Jeff Gordon's times in the 24.
Don't get that rocking chair ready for Mark Martin just yet. He's still got a lot of racing to do. He's had a good bit of road course success for Jack Roush, and now he's got Scott Pruitt breathing down his neck. Now, Pruitt ran in IMSA and Trans Am for Jack Roush, so there's some history there. And, of course, now drives for Chip Ganassi in an occasional road course start in NASCAR.
Well, when Roush came to a Cup with his Cup teams, they really ran well on the road courses because of all that history in the Trans Am.
And we had Scott on our trackside show Friday night. He's raced in about everything that I could find except drag racing. He's won in about everything. He said, you just can't imagine how much winning a Nextel Cup race to me would mean.
He's from California, from Roseville, started his career winning in go-karts.
And Ron Fellows said the same thing, echoed the same thing.
Jeff Gordon and Tony Stewart lead. The first of those ringers is Pruitt in sixth and Boris Said in eighth.
Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is brought to you by Allstate, official partner of NASCAR.
Enter the weekly Gillette Young Guns Challenge. One lucky fan who correctly picks the top placing Gillette Young Gun each week will win $5,000. Check it out at GilletteYoungGuns.com. Enter for your chance to win. It's brought to you by M3 Power, the world's best shave. Here's where the Gillette Young Guns stand. And Nextel Cup. All right, Jeff Gordon's lead on Tony Stewart stable, 0.8 seconds. Robbie Gordon up to third. Kurt Busch putting the pressure on Scott Pruitt to move into the top five.
One of the things that's going to change this race and these cars, the sun's out, Larry. They haven't been on the racetrack when the sun's been out.
And this racetrack will get slick. Now, we talked about Robbie Gordon, the 7 car, his equipment, Dick Berman, he may be having a problem.
Well, he definitely is having a problem, Larry Mack. He just got on the radio and explained to his crew that the right front is locking up entering the turns. So that's not a good situation. The other issue he is going to have to face will be on pit road. New tire changers. One was brand new last week. Another one is going to be new today. So with just 2 pit stops in this event for most teams, the pit stops are extremely critical. Can't mess up one because there aren't a bunch more to make up for it.
One of the things about locking that right front up, you're going to flat spot it, and then you're going to have a flat tire.
And that's obviously happening under braking.
You're watching from Boris Said, the Centrix Financial Chevy, as he closes right on the back bumper of Mark Martin, who has fallen back a bit. What's wrong with Mark?
Mike, we've talked a lot about the weather yesterday. It was overcast, start of the day similar, but the sun is out now. Mark Martin battling a loose race car on the left-hand turns, and now with the sun out, it's going to be even looser.
I tell you something else that happens. You get hot in that race car. Jimmy Johnson just got past there.
Scott Pruitt.
But you get hot in that race car because you didn't realize how hot it's going to be this afternoon.
Jimmy loses another position to Kurt Busch in the 97 car.
I don't know, though, Larry. No, Jimmy is dropping back. I was going to say, if somebody's hounding you, that's a good place to let him go so you don't slow up both of you. But Jimmy is backing up.
Yeah, he's got a problem.
He's in trouble.
You know what he did? I think he knocked the tire down. He went really big-time airborne over the curbs up there.
And we can't say enough, Jeff Hammond, how important it is to keep that car not only from spinning out, but keep it on the racetrack.
You've got to keep it on the racetrack, Larry. But I also noticed that when he was getting past about that time, there was smoke coming out of this race car. I'm wondering if he's got another problem that we're not aware of. Maybe he's locked up a brake and got a problem, something with the transmission.
Well, Jeff, when I saw the car, it was really up in the air. And you can obviously see he's got a transmission problem.
And he could have easily spun it, maybe knocked the tooth off in there, Darrell, or got it messed up as far as the gear. He may only have high gear.
Yeah,
he doesn't look very fast right now, like maybe he will not shift.
That's what it looks like, Jeff. That car will not accelerate off the corner. Once it gets to speed, for example, down the S's, Johnson was as fast as the cars he was running with. But the car will not accelerate. See, there goes Terry Labonte.
We talked at the top of the show, only 11 drivers within that 400-point window of leader Jimmy Johnson. This is what these guys that's outside of that window would be looking for. Jimmy Johnson having a problem here today.
Well, and I believe you're going to have more gearbox problems today than we've had forever, because they're using the gearboxes with the gear rule. They're using a lot different gear ratios here than they've run in the past.
Dick, what's the problem with our point leader?
Third gear, Mike. It doesn't exist anymore in Jimmy Johnson's car. He has now dropped back to 10th position. That's a tough gear to lose out here.
He better get to pits and get it and change that gearbox. He's just going to lose valuable time.
Yeah, because normally when one gear goes out, the others are about to follow. But you're right. You could get by losing high gear here. Then you would just run first, second, and third. But third gear, that's a killer.
No, and if the transmission goes out at the far end of the speedway, he's done. He's stuck up there.
Right, because if he broke off a couple of teeth off that gear, Jeff, those teeth have to go somewhere, and that somewhere is somewhere else in that gearbox.
Mike, that's what's going to happen to this transmission. And Darrell, Larry, you're dead on about what needs to be done to this 48 car. But if you're going to be out there, let the crew get everything laid out. You can get a special fire extinguisher to cool that transmission down, make it a little easier for you to change it when you do come in, get everything organized, and who knows, you may catch a caution. When they slow everything down here, it'll make it easier for this team to make the transition and maybe be able to save some valuable time. Dick Berger, what's going on, buddy?
Jeff Hammond, they have just dispatched a couple of guys from Jimmy Johnson's pit to the garage area to get a backup transmission out and get it ready. Crew Chief Chad Canal said it's either that or we're going to have to suffer through this day. But I think Jeff Hammond's right. If they can catch a caution before they get in trouble with this transmission, certainly you're going to lose a lot less time changing it as a caution period's out than you would under green flag racing.
Yeah, I'd just be worried about it just laying down on me up on the end of the racetrack and can't get back to the garage.
But Jeff, with what I said about parts flying around inside that gearbox, don't the teams run a big magnet on the drain plug and maybe in another location to catch anything that breaks loose inside there?
For the big stuff, Mike, it does. You got magnets in there to try to pull everything to the bottom in case you do break a tooth. But the problem is all that little stuff running around here is just grinding the rest of the teeth and compounding the problem. So you've got to, it's just a matter of time. This is a time bomb ticking on the 48 car. It will break and it will eventually tear up the rest of the transmission and he won't be able to go anywhere. So they're going to have to change it. And we see Dale Earnhardt Jr., they've got repairs made to that car and he's headed back out.
Now he is 14 laps down trying to salvage the best of this day that he can. Our leader is Jeff Gordon. He's been out in front for all 17 laps, Matt.
Gordon has been quiet on the radio, but his team has been busy here in the pit. They've sent some crew members back to the truck and pull out a transmission just in case they do indeed have the same problem their teammate Jimmy Johnson has. They're not sure whether Johnson's was a mechanical failure, part failure, or if it was self-inflicted, so they're not taking any chances. They're prepared as well, but Gordon has said nothing on the radio. He's just out front, yard in the field.
Remember, the drivers here generally upshift without using the clutch. The transmissions are set up to do that, and usually everything works just fine. 17 laps complete. Jeff Gordon continues to lead Tony Stewart by less than a second. They have 4 seconds on Robbie Gordon.
Nextel Fan of the Week, go to www.foxsports.com/Nextel. Enter today, and you could be next. Just had a caution come out. Debris on the track. Jimmy Johnson fading a little bit. Of course, our question earlier was, might we see a points change? Greg Biffle within 31 currently as we stand. Mike Joy?
And right now, Biffle is 27th in the race, while Johnson, having transmission trouble, drops to 34th, both still on the lead lap. Caution for debris. A lot of contact on the road course here, and that means a lot of pieces of sheet metal going errant.
But now this caution, it should help Jimmy Johnson, Chad Knauss, the 48 team. Jeff Hammond talked about it, a caution to save him more time changing that transmission. But let me tell you what the biggest thing this caution is going to do. It's going to chop things up. We talked about running this race backwards from lap 110. If you can run 40 laps, you know you need to be on pit road by lap 70. And by lap 30, we're about 10 laps away from that window. I think we're going to see a lot of cars pit, but I think we'll see a lot of cars stay out because this is the way you run a road course race.
And you never want to see your competition have bad luck. But if you're over 400 points out of the chase right now, having Jimmy Johnson in trouble, having Biffle at the back, that pulls some people back in the chase.
Now, with the caution out at lap 21, knowing you can pit here without losing a lap, I think I'd stay out because this field's going to be all bunched up, and when they get the restart, am I going to lose less time versus the leader if I wait and pit under green?
There is no question. Those guys at the front, I think they'll stay out because you want to pit under green here. I mean, that's the thing you want to do. We talked about it at the top of the show. If your car's good, two pit stops. Keep it to two pit stops, and if you pit under green, it doesn't matter because you're not going to lose a lap here, just as you're seeing Jeff Gordon, Tony Stewart, Robbie Gordon, all these guys staying out. But we'll see them on pit road in about 10 to 12 laps. I know it sounds confusing, but it's the way you run a road course race.
I agree. Darrell, 20 laps, you've had a chance to find your rhythm. You know how the car's going to be. You know how it's going to react. Do you need tires right now?
Well, these tires seem to be wearing pretty well. I haven't heard anybody complain about them. And it's the same tire we had here last year, so I think we're fine.
Oh, nope. Yeah, you want tires now. Trust me, those drivers in the front are going, are you sure?
Did I say need? Want versus need. These fellows in the back need tires now. And here they come, including Jimmy Johnson with transmission difficulties just ahead of Ron Fellows. That's Fellows, the Canadian road race ace.
I have no idea what the road speed is. Just be smooth. It doesn't matter. We got to start tailing.
Dick Bergeron.
Well, Jimmy Johnson is going to come into his pits, and they have already told him to shut the engine off. They're going to try to work on that transmission, do whatever they can here. Seems rather curious, pretty hard to fix a transmission without taking it out and working on the inside of it, but they're going to try to fix it in the car right here on pit road.
Well, it could be a linkage problem, then that's what they're going to check first. That they could repair in the pits.
Get him over there.
Michael Waltrip was the first of those who came to pit road, and
he came in 23rd.
Jeff Hammond can tell us more about linkages and transmissions.
Mike, right now, what we have here at the cutaway car is what they call a single rail transmission shifter. If you'll notice, one rod that works all four gears. Probably, with them talking about going underneath the 48 car, is that Jimmy's car has what they call shifter rods located down the side of the transmission, and they're hoping that maybe one of those has gotten bent and it's not allowing the transmission to work effectively. When you're shifting, allowing the dogs to work in and get into first, second, third gear, fourth, whenever you need to. What he's done is he's actually torn the teeth probably off of third gear. If that's the case, they'll have to come in, cut the engine off, pull the drive shaft loose. They'll also have to pull the exhaust system off the race car, remove the shifter stick itself, and then pull the whole transmission out and install a new one. As I said earlier, what they'd like to have happen, and let everything get kind of cooled down a little bit, and they may also have some types of either a water hose or a fire extinguisher with halon in it that they can spray this transmission, cool it off, where the pit crew can go ahead and work on it and make the change as quick as possible.
Let's show you what got Jimmy in trouble. Or where the trouble may have started.
I think he comes down this hill and when I saw the car, look how high it is right there. And then it comes over here, and I think he may have just juked the transmission real hard. That's what gets you in trouble.
And this could possibly be the cause of the transmission problem. We don't know that, but all these things can contribute to it.
Well, it started right after that, so I'd say it is.
So when that right rear wheel gets up in the air and then comes back down and grabs traction again, that can snap a lot of things.
Oh, yeah, it could break your transmission. It could even break your rear end gear.
Sterling Marlin penalized along with Chris Cook in the 87. Too fast exiting the pits.
And that is a huge penalty here because, I mean, the end of the longest line here is about a mile.
It's over in Napa.
Yeah. Or
we had about 15 cars that pitted, including Greg Biffle in the 16. That's two pit stops he's made. but we know he still have to make two more stops.
Well, he's just trying to get position every time he can, keep tires on so he can stay out longer than everybody else. If we ever cycle through the green flag stops.
We basically had about our top 25 cars stay out. We know they will start making that green flag stop if we stay green in about 10 to 12 laps. They won't worry about those cars in front of them. They're running their own race right now.
That car right there, Robbie Gordon, was one of the question marks in the first green flag run. He looks under Stewart for second. Bad choice trying to get there at the keyhole. Now they're into the S's for an update on Robbie Gordon. Here's Dick.
Well, Robbie Gordon's car bike turns out to be in really good shape. We heard earlier that he was dragging the tire, the front tire, going into the corners and assumed he was talking about his own car. It wasn't. He was talking about somebody else's car that he was watching on the racetrack. Said a moment ago on the radio that his car is so good, he's just playing with everybody else out here. Meanwhile, Jimmy Johnson, car number 48. They've now got a final diagnosis on the transmission. It is stuck in third gear. It is the only gear he has got. Steve Burns.
Dick, Kurt Busch, one of the drivers, electing not to pit, running in the fourth position. He just told crew chief Jimmy Fenech that his car is tight to the left, loose to the right.
And that's one of the challenges at a road course, because you're turning left and you're turning right. It makes the changes that you need to make to that race car very complicated, and you don't get very many opportunities. But Darrell, you talked about it. We saw on Friday, basically when this racetrack got hot, these cars got ill driving. Yesterday's practice was very cool. They drove pretty good. Now it's hot again.
Did you see that leap by Kurt Busch? He almost jumped right onto Scott Pruitt's trunk coming up and over the hill.
Well, they're all pouncing all over the 7 car here, and he's got a problem.
He's stuck in gear, we're told, Darrell.
Oh, really?
Here's Dick.
Well, yeah, Robbie Gordon apparently is stuck in gear, stuck in second gear. He is on the radio right now, and he is one unhappy race car driver. Well, he knew he had a good race car, and then we talked about it, mechanical failures.
I've just seen so much transmission trouble this year on ovals. What do you expect when we get here where you shift?
Stuck in third gear.
Yeah. Stuck in third gear, just like Jimmy Johnson.
If he was running that speed in second gear, we'd have parts all down through the S's. Mark Martin to take advantage of Robbie Gordon. Darrell, remember back to Mexico City where we went road racing with the Busch Series cars. We had a lot of transmission issues there.
It's the shifters, and Jeff showed us that shifter that's a single rail shifter, they call them. I think that's where a lot of these problems have come from.
And you see where it's really hurting Robbie Gordon in the 7 car is off the slow corners where you would normally be in first or second gear to lunge off the corner.
I'm kind of like Dale Jr. about his transmission. That Owen worked pretty good.
Jeff Gordon and Tony Stewart have both driven a very disciplined race through 24 laps. The gap between them has remained pretty constant from 0.6 seconds to 1 second. Matt is in Stewart's pit.
You talk about the patience and the controlled drive both are having. Greg Zipadelli left a little piece of tape on Tony's dash. He said, relax, just do it, be patient. Stewart says the car, as the sun continues to stay out, needs more and more grip. He says now it is shoving the nose, it's tight.
He was complaining about that yesterday in practice. Even though he was fast, he was sliding the front tires. Man, that makes it difficult on a road course when it won't turn.
Laps complete as they cross the stripe in the Dodge Save Mart 350 at Infineon Raceway.
Jeff Gordon leading Tony Stewart. It's NASCAR on Fox from Sonoma, California at Infineon Raceway. 27 laps in, 83 to go. Road course specialist Scott Pruitt currently running third. As we check some of the other Dodge Chargers and how well they're doing today, Ryan Newman in the top 10 in points, has yet to win a race this year, doing well here. And Jamie McMurray, who finished second in this race last year, currently running 10th. And Mike, we're getting ready for, at least for the leader, scheduled pit stops coming up here in the next 5 or 6 laps or so.
Shouldn't be too long. And, you know, thinking about Jeff Gordon's domination here and his chance to pull back within 400 points of the leader, Gordon has a chance here, of course, an odds-on chance to win this race. but also to lead the most laps, and also to keep anybody else from leading a lap. We've run 27 laps, and nobody else has been able to put that five-point bonus up on the board.
It's exactly what he did last year. He sat on the butt pole. He led 92 of 110 laps. The only laps he did not lead was through the sequence of pit stops.
While we were away, we saw how treacherous the paperclip-shaped turn 11 can be here at Sonoma, and when cars are running close together. Watch the 88 of Dale Jarrett. He's just coming into the corner. Right there, and inside him is Carl Edwards in the 99, and so on, and so on, and so on. And who got the worst of it? The zero, Mike Bliss.
Carl Edwards, he's going to sneak through the infield here, but a lot of damage to the front of Mike Bliss in that zero car, and this all happened right in front of Greg Biffle in that 16.
No caution. We've only had two so far. The first one for Dale Earnhardt Jr. and the second for debris. And as of this moment, with the positions they're running, Greg Biffle would take over the lead in the Nextel Cup standings.
And his car looks really good. I mean, I know he's been in the pit a little bit more than these other guys, got maybe a little better tires, but he looks good.
And just remember, two races ago at Pocono, he had the brake problem. That's when Jimmy Johnson really stretched the lead out. And then last week, Jimmy Johnson just a mediocre run at Michigan. Biffle gained a bunch back on him after winning the race.
Jeff Green went off at turn seven in a big cloud of dust, but got right back on. Again, no caution.
Now, we'll be coming to lap 30 the next time by. That's basically 80 laps to go. What these crew chiefs and teams are doing right now, they're trying to figure what lap they need to get to pit road and make this race on one more stop. You hopefully come to pit road under green, as Dale Jarrett in the 88 is doing right now with a lot of damage from that wreck while ago. Then in the perfect world, after you make your green flag pit stop, you get a caution. That traps everyone to where they have to make that pit stop under yellow. They'll come out behind you.
Ricky Rudd makes the pass on Kenny Schrader. That's for 15th position.
Watching the lap times, the tires have not fallen off very much. I mean, it's not going to be a matter of needing tires as much as it's going to be needing fuel.
Hey, who's closing on the leader is Kurt Busch, not known as a road racer. He is giving Scott Pruett all he can handle down at turn 11.
But he's driving one of Jack Roush's cars, and Jack is known as a road racer. So I think that helps.
30 laps complete. Jeff Gordon leads Tony Stewart by 1.4 seconds. Pit stops coming up.
NASCAR from Northern California, from the state of California, Joe DiMaggio, Mark McGwire, born here. And if you think you're the ultimate baseball fan, watch the 2005 Major League Baseball All-Star Game live here on Fox, July 12th, 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. Get the password for your chance to win the Pepsi Go Pro contest. Pepsi, the official drink of Major League Baseball. Jeff Hammond coming up on the pit stops here. What can we anticipate?
Well, I think we've already seen some pit stops. I saw the 11 car, Terry Labonte down there. I think the 01 of Joe Nemechek has come to pit road. There he is right now receiving service on his car. We talk about the number of stops that these teams need to make. The one thing that's kind of come to play this year is he stalls at Kevin Harvick, stalls at 29 car to get him refired. Is that this year we have a green-white checker in place, so it could factor in. A lot of these guys are cutting it pretty close, and they don't want to lose sight that they need to get these cars full and maybe add an extra lap just in case we have a green-white checker.
All right, Mike.
Jeff Gordon is in. Tony Stewart harassed him for the last two laps, hoping to lead a lap before the stop. So Quaker State pit stops. Here's Matt.
Stewart will go on to pick up five bonus points. Meanwhile, Jeff Gordon pulling his way to the same pit stall that he used last year when he went to Victory Lane here at the Infinity End Raceway. He says the car is tight in the center, but the biggest issue, forward bite. It just spins the tires up off the corner, especially in turns 7 and 11. An air pressure adjustment for Super G. Lugs are out a little bit slow in the left rear, but he is away. Hitting Margaret.
When veteran Cup drivers hear the crew chief say next time by, they know it means to pit. Lee McCall, crew chief for Scott Pruett, said it three times before Pruett said, what next time by? And McCall said pit. So here he is now getting his four tires and two cans of fuel. A minor adjustment. The car is pushing a little bit. Pruitt's on his way. He has been very fast today.
Morris said pitted with him. So did Ryan Newman, Jamie McMurray, Elliott Sadler, Kyle Busch in the pit lane, along with Mayfield and Blaney.
Now, I think we'll see Tony Stewart hit pit road this time because he couldn't afford to stay out there and catch a caution, because then he'd have to pit under caution. There he is on pit road now. He was holding his breath for that minute and 18 seconds.
And Scott Pruitt, there's a good example of not working with your team.
Too fast exiting for rookie Kyle Busch. Steve?
And Mike, the spotter's telling Kurt Busch, be careful getting off pit road. They're busting up for speeding. Remember, Kurt said his car was tight to the left, loose to the right. There they make a chassis adjustment. One turn in the right rear. Matt?
And you've got both the Home Depot team waiting for the 20 of Stewart to come in, and Mark Martin's team waving their flag as well. Stewart, tight. No forward grip. They're going to make a chassis adjustment as Mark Martin is in. He stopped short in his box to help his exit in case Stewart has a slow stop. Gloves are on. Stewart is away. A slight hesitation. Meanwhile, Mark Martin waiting for the jack. The six, Mark Martin will have a penalty. Too fast entering pit road. So he will be back.
Rusty Wallace gets four tires and fuel. Matt Kenseth is in. Dick.
Jeff Burton gets his fuel and his fresh tires as well, and he is out of here. This is not the same car that Robbie Gordon had driven and done so very well with, although it looks to be the same.
Carl Edwards is in, Scott Wimmer, and Robbie Gordon. And we'll get an update on Kyle Busch. The official is still holding him at the end of pit road. No, the car will not start. The car will not crank, they're telling him, Matt.
Mike, they are saying some type of transmission issues, possibly for the five of Kyle Busch, teammate to Jimmy Johnson.
And it's a long run for that team down pit road. It's going to be another minute or two before they get there. Kyle Petty assumes the lead based on pit stops. He gets his 5 points. That is, he is the third leader today.
Yeah, but look who's going to be leading after Kyle goes in the pits.
He'll get 5 points, but he's off sequence.
Right.
But we pretty much know he will still have to make two pit stops, and everyone
you
just came
leader,
to pit road.
Now let's go back to Tony Stewart. Darrell, when Jeff Gordon peeled off to pit, staying on the racetrack was the easiest 5 points, easiest lap that Tony Stewart will lead all day.
Oh, yeah, that's what you hope for. You hope that that guy will pit before you have to. Get those 5 points. It just tells you how critical 5 points are to all these guys right now.
Robbie Gordon, Ricky Rudd, too fast exiting pit road. He'll be back for a penalty. Mark Martin is in for his drive through.
So that's about four cars that were in the top 15 that's had pit road speeding problems. Mark Martin, Kyle Busch, Robbie Gordon, Ricky Rudd. Of course, Kyle Busch's problems continue. He still sits at the end of pit road.
His crew is running down to try to get men. It must have been a long way down there because they are got their tongues hanging out.
Now they'll get there to Kyle's aid. So the lead cycles around during pit stops to where Greg Biffle, who is off sequence, is the leader. Ron Fellows, the Canadian driver, second. P.J. Jones in the Morgan McClure number 4 is third. And Brian Simo, a Trans Am racer, who's picked up a one-race deal in the 33, is fourth ahead of Bobby Labonte, Travis Quapple, and then the drivers who pitted, beginning with Jeff Gordon.
Now, Greg Biffle in the 16, I'm just not sure that staying out more laps after leading that lap, getting those 5 points, I'm going to have to think about this a little bit, maybe while we're at break, what he's gaining here.
You think about it. We'll be right back. You're watching NASCAR on Fox.
Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is brought to you by Budweiser, the official beer of NASCAR, and proud sponsors of Dale Earnhardt Jr. and the number 8 car. Greg Biffle, your leader. He's won 5 of the 15 races this year and time 4 of his race break. We're on lap 38, 72 to go here in Sonoma at Infineon Raceway. Things starting early for Dale Earnhardt Jr. on lap 3, a brush with Bliss. Problems there. He qualified 10th, but Jr. wrecks here. Had to go out of the race for a while, went 14 laps down, and was frustrated about it.
You know, he had a good car, you know, and the old transmission was pretty dang good, so I don't know why it wasn't in there to start with.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. struggling. He's never finished in the top 10 here. Hendrick Motorsports having some problems as well. Jimmy Johnson, the points leader, was fourth on lap 14, dropped to 16th. Just two laps later with transmission problems as they tried to correct those problems in the pit stop. Also, Kyle Busch having some problems, another Hendrick Motorsports driver. And that's where we stand to the moment. Jeff has talked about where Junior was a year ago. We've been documenting this week by week, and it doesn't look to get any better today.
No, it doesn't. Right now, you can see he was 503 points behind coming in here. He hasn't led a lap today, so, I mean, he's going to be in a deeper hole before we leave here.
He has returned to the race. As we mentioned, this has been a Visa race break and a good time to check in on our singular crew chief question. Which driver has the best chance of making the chase? I know, Jeff, you predicted that Dale Jarrett would. Dale Earnhardt Jr. would not on our pre-race show. Matt Kenseth is in the mix, so we'd like to hear from you. To vote, text the word crew to 191 on your singular wireless phone or go to foxsports.com. You'll also be entered for a chance to drive away in your own singular 31 car. Let's rejoin Daryl, Larry, and Mike.
40 laps into this race at Infineon, Greg Biffle, who made a pit stop at lap 21, is the race leader. He's off sequence with the drivers who stopped about 10 laps later. And look at Ron Fellows, the Canadian, coming off a runner-up finish in the GT class at the 24 Hours of Le Mans. He is second. Brian Simo, another road course ringer, in third. Scott Pruitt, PJ Jones, his car has dropped off just a bit. He's given up a couple of spots in the last two laps for a set, trying to work back up through. And Chris Cook and Tom Hubert, and my almost ringer Terry Labonte running in 11th place, in that he's no longer on the current full schedule of Nextel Cup Racing. Joe Gibbs Racing had him replace Jason Leffler for this one event, trying to keep the FedEx number 11 in the top 35 in Nextel Cup owner points. Matt Jeff Gordon trying to work his way up through. He's climbed to fourth, but he's got Bobby Labonte all over him.
Mike, he has bigger issues. Jeff Gordon just told Robbie Loomis, I have something amiss with the transmission. I believe it is stuck in fourth gear. Another Hendrick car, possibly snake bitten, with transmission trouble today. He and Robbie trying to formulate a game plan of what to do. One, obviously, point they're going to do is probably bring the car back to the garage. They're formulating that game plan as we speak.
And he was definitely one of the cars, even though it's his teammate, that was going to capitalize on Jimmy Johnson having the problems. Because remember, Jeff Gordon comes in here over 400 points out of the lead and looked like he had the car to beat.
Just said going to the garage next time, so he's not going to ride around like Jimmy is.
Is that, you want to come to the garage here, Jeff?
Yeah, 2-4, let's go to the garage. Well, yeah, caution's out.
Caution is out as Rusty Wallace comes to pit road unexpectedly. Wallace was just in about six laps ago in the Miller Lite Dodge.
This is good.
I think what Rusty Wallace may have suspected, he may have suspected that caution. He made it on the pit road past the commit line before the caution actually was displayed.
Because I heard Robbie Loomis tell Jeff Gordon, caution's coming out. And the caution hadn't come out at that point.
So Rusty gets a free stop, if you will, not to be confused with the free pass. Let's go back to Matt.
Originally, they were going to bring the 24 car back to the garage, but then Robbie Loomis said, let's take a look at it on pit road. We spoke at the beginning of the show how important the next 2 weeks are for Jeff Gordon, places where he's won and run well. He needs to capitalize. They are going to have another bad day, more issues chasing that fifth championship here today.
Gordon led the first 32 laps here from the pole, gave way to Tony Stewart when Jeff made his pit stop. At lap 33, Kyle Petty has also led a lap, and Greg Biffle has been out front for the last seven times around this 11-turn course.
Now our top three, Greg Biffle, Ron Fellows, and Brian Simo, they were last on pit road at lap 21. We know fuel-wise they can probably go to about lap 56 or to lap 61, which would be about 15 to 20 laps from now.
This caution is for debris, and it was in the shoot out of turn 10 leading to 11. And so I think you're right. It's likely Rusty Wallace saw the debris, made the left turn onto pit road, and caution came out. Dick?
Well, that may be likely. What really happened, Mike, was they had problems fueling the car on the last pit stop. The little nozzle that goes into the fuel tank itself just didn't connect quite correctly with the car. They were unable to get all of the fuel into the car. And remembering last year when he ran out of gas while running in the top five, Rusty came back in again and they filled the tank.
Well, that'll happen, Dick. You make up a good story and it gets ruined with facts.
And then probably what happened is they're really, really lucky.
Yes, that's what happened.
That's
he and Larry
probably
Carter
what happened.
Were really lucky. Good luck for Rusty Wallace. Bad luck on the right of your screen. Jeff Gordon under transmission repair as we are under caution. Caution out for the third time today. Debris between turn 10 and 11, and our three leaders choose to pit. Greg Biffle, Ron Fellows, Brian Simo come to pit road. Here's Biffle's stop.
And I know Doug Rich or Greg Biffle, they're trying so hard to pull strategy after starting back in the 41st position, but they just can't get out of the box they're in, because here, with 67 laps to go, they're still going to have to make another stop. And we pretty much know all of our guys like Tony Stewart, Kurt Busch, Scott Pruitt, Boris Said, Ryan Newman, they're only going to make one more stop, and he's going to restart way behind all those guys. It's just a tough box to get out of.
Ron Fellows also stopped under this caution, gave up second place to do so. Now, several of the Hendrick cars, including front row starters Jimmy Johnson and Jeff Gordon, the pole sitter, have had transmission trouble. Matt?
And Jeff Gordon has left pit road about 2 minutes ago. He says we've got first and second. Steve Letarte headed up the repair work. Now he says he has all four gears, but he has lost a lot of time.
Now, before Jeff Gordon had this difficulty, he was within 400 points of the leader in the top 10 and on pace. But Larry, I don't know about Greg Biffle's strategy. Darrell, what do you think? It's kind of a free stop. The caution's out. You get back to, now you've got fresher tires than the fellas you've been racing against. I think things may cycle around to them.
Well, that's what they're hoping. And the problem is these single file restarts. When you come in and you got to restart so far back in line, they're just hoping for a miracle.
The only thing I think I would have done different, I'm not up here second guessing Doug Richard, right, is I would have got my 5 points, let it out, come to pit road, knowing I only had to make one more stop like everyone else.
Good point.
He's running some kind of fuel mileage race is what he's trying to do.
Which when you start at 41st, 110 lap race, it's about all you can do.
Kyle Busch behind the wall under repair. Trouble on Robbie Gordon, who came across the start-finish line, almost stopped, and then grabbed the gear and got going.
Yeah, he's got, we know he has transmission issues.
Goodyear aerial coverage showing you the pack going down through the S's and headed for turn number 10, building speed much of the way. And at the top right of your screen, they get to turn 10 where it's a stab of the brake and steer and hope the track is wide enough at the exit. I think, Darrell, it's the most challenging part of this racetrack is to carry enough speed through turn 10 that they don't beat you down here into 11.
Two different ways of driving turn 10. Some guys catch third gear getting in there. Other guys leave it in high gear and lug around that corner. Makes it a whole lot easier to drive than when you're trying to catch a downshift getting in there.
A lot of different agendas here. Tony Stewart is our leader from Kurt Busch, Scott Pruitt, Boris Said, and Ryan Newman after pit stops have cycled around. Greg Biffle gave up the lead to make a stop under this caution. He's now running in 29th. Matt's in his pit.
Working some different strategy here, Doug. You stayed out, finally pitted. Where do you stand now?
Well, you know, I guess the plus side is we were able to lead a lap for that 5 extra points, but the other thing it does, I know it sets us back in the field, but it leaves us making one more pit stop if it does stay green. So whatever, you know, positions we can gain from here, it's not a two-stop race for us. If it went green, I'd have to make two more stops under green, and that would be even worse. So we're playing a little safety here right now, I guess. It doesn't look good on the monitor, but hopefully we can work ourselves back up there.
On the monitor, he's currently in the 29th position, Mike.
But what looks good on the monitor is the fact that Jimmy Johnson, the points leader, who he was just a few points behind, is having problems today. So they need to play it safe. They don't need to gamble right here today.
Well, one thing he doesn't want to do is create another problem by not getting fuel and not getting tires when he can. So, I mean, you got to take advantage of that.
Stewart the leader. He's been flawless all day, whether it's been tracking Jeff Gordon, maintaining the 1 second interval, or out in front with the lead. Here is the Mr. Excitement of American road racing, Boris Said. Hop those curves, lift a wheel or two, make the bold move. Last year, he drove the whole Nextel Cup race here and then went out and wired the Trans Am race, led it from green to checker.
You had a real fast lap right there. That tire pressure help you?
I think so, Frank. I mean, I'm still trying to baby. I'm going to see how it is the last 10 or 15. That's where we'll gauge it off before I decide about any more changes. But it feels pretty good, just being mellow.
Boris talking to Frank Stoddard, his crew chief.
Of course, in the opening of the show, we rode with Boris, and we saw the fancy footwork that he can do. And that's why he can hustle a car a little harder than other guys, because watch it. He's got such a great technique. And this is how you take care of your stuff.
And Darrell, you talked about it at the top of the show. He's upshifting without the clutch, just with the RPMs. Never see that left foot hit the clutch on the upshift.
And look how big the brake pedal is.
Whoa!
You just blip it. You're just matching RPM. You give it a little blip, throw it up in another gear.
I think that double pump on the brake, Darrell, that's almost like a little security.
That's a driver thing. We all do that. I mean, even when you got a full pedal, you pop it a couple of times.
Now, there's the downshift with the clutch.
And you see him get the heel over there.
Morris got just gently into the back of somebody with the nose of that car. I believe that was in one of those accordion-like runs down into turn 11 earlier.
Just see, but think how hard this guy's working. Look at his hands up there steering that car. He's got his feet in it down here. He's got his legs moving around.
In last year, he drove all three races here. The NASCAR Southwest Tour, the Trans Am race, and the Nextel Cup race. Wrote a long feature article in Automobile Magazine that came out later last summer, and he said by far the hardest of the three races was this one, the Cup race. He says because these NASCAR guys, they go hard every single lap.
Well, a lot of that is just, you know, you can either instinctively be able to do this like Boris is doing, or you got to be taught how to do it. But road racing is a technique.
I'll tell you what, a car I've been watching all day long, Jeff Burton in the 31 car, started back in the 15th position. He's been staying out of trouble. You see a little bit of damage to the right front. He's one of the cars, no strategy there. He has to make one more pit stop. He's moved up to the 6th position, but remember his crew chief, Kevin Hamlin, won this race 2 years ago with Robbie Gordon driving that 31 car. Just look at the range of RPMs. Down to 4,400 RPMs in the middle of the corner, all the way up to over 9,000 on the longer straightaway, which is not a very long straightaway here.
Not at all, but you get up a lot of speed going down through here now. You're hearing him catch high gear. Hearing him blip the gas, that just matches up the gear so it doesn't scrape.
Less than 40 miles an hour in the middle of turn 11.
That's 100 mile an hour from the straightaway down to that speed in the corner. 100 mile an hour drop. And he got some damage there on that left front fender, or right front fender. That's where that smoke was coming from. Heavy braking, gets that fender down into the tire.
He's coming down the hill into turn 4. And here he comes up through 3 and 3A. At turn 3A is where, and there's the smoke again, same place. 3A is where a lot of drivers like to hike the curbing, and that's where you get those great still shots in the magazines where these NASCAR cars have two wheels off the ground as they try to shortcut that corner.
And then that's the turn also where you can't see anything as you come over the top of that turn. You've got to pick up something way up in front of you, like a grandstand or something. Like lining up a shot on the golf course where you can't see the green.
Yeah, it's a blind rise, and it's a leap of faith when you come up there with two wheels in the air. Dick Bergeron.
Well, if it looks as if Robbie Gordon is a lot faster now, it's because he is. They have got the transmission fixed. He's now got all four forward speeds. And you guys were wondering about that little spot a few laps ago where he slowed down, wondered if the transmission had failed again. You're not going to believe this one. He had a piece of sheet metal come loose inside the car, took his hands off the wheel to fix it. That's why he slowed down a little bit.
Yeah, he's exciting to watch, too. Tony Stewart, your leader by 2.5 seconds over Kurt Busch. Robbie Gordon, a lap down as we've completed 50 here at Infineon Raceway in Sonoma, California. You're watching NASCAR on Fox.
Tony Stewart leading, 52 laps in, 58 to go. Let's check out the Coca-Cola family of racing, and Tony Stewart leading the way. Kurt Busch making an impressive run, currently a second. Michael Waltrip, Elliott Sadler, Kyle Petty did have a lead for a lap earlier. Greg Biffle, who led for a while, back to 28th, and Bobby Labonte rounding things out. In the chase for the Nextel Cup, this is race 16, number 26, the cutoff here. You see the points and where they're currently running. So our points leader, 36, fading a bit. Kurt Busch has moved to the front of the pack. And where they would stand currently based on the points, and a big jump for Kurt Busch. Jeff, he'd be up to third right now, holding it on Jimmy Johnson.
He just keeps plugging away. He's had a real dismal first half of the year, but he keeps hanging in there.
Tony Stewart has led twice today, took the lead lap on 43. And Tony Stewart, his last win has been 29 races. It was a road course at Watkins Glen, as Jeff Gordon, who led the most laps today, 32, is now a lap down behind the pack off the lead lap as Tony Stewart leads Kurt Busch and Scott Pruett. Mike?
Thanks, Chris. A quick review of the road course ringers as we ride with Joe Nemechek. Scott Pruett third, Boris Said in fourth right now. Terry Labonte running a partial schedule, and a road race expert is eighth. Road course ringers won 10 of the first 31 road races in NASCAR. Dan Gurney, the most prolific of those winners, as there's how the seven drivers are running right now. But they're 0 for 66 recently. No ringer has won in Nextel Cup since Mark Donahue won at Riverside, California in January of 1973.
Now we're riding with Terry Labonte right here in the 11 car. And remember, this is Jason Leffler's ride. But this team came out to Sonoma Infineon Speedway 36 in owner points. It's been nail-biting every week having to qualify for these events. That's the reason they put Terry Labonte in this race car for one race, mainly to have a good run, but to catapult, hopefully, into the top 35 in owner points. And right now, I'd say running in the top 10, he's running right where he qualified in eighth. This very well will take some pressure off this team with Jason back in the car next week at Daytona. Jason Leffler only has one road course start in a Busch car at Watkins Glen several years ago.
And he's pretty darn good at Daytona, too, so he almost won the Busch race down there last year. So he'll be a good guy to keep an eye on when we get to Daytona.
It's fun to watch Terry Labonte at work because he doesn't look like he's working. He is so smooth in that car.
They don't call him the Iceman for nothing.
Nope, look, Sunday drive.
That's right.
Now right behind him comes Matt Kenseth, running in ninth place. He's the second Ford in the race, and a car's hit the wall, and it is Casey Kane from the turn seven. And that will put us under caution for the fourth time today.
Casey Kane had worked his way up into the top 15 before this happened.
Let's check. More damage on Brian Vicker's car. He had some earlier. Here's Steve.
Yeah, Mike, we had just heard Casey Kane saying or complaining about the throttle sticking on his 9 car.
See here, Steve.
Down the short chute, headed into turn 7.
Whoa, yeah.
Yeah.
That. Whoa. Oh. That's how he got in there. I knew he and Vickers had made contact.
Vickers actually slowed him down just a little bit as he
got
was headed
him, actually got
that
him
wall.
Turned around. Yeah, I think that's had to be for that. He may have gone head on.
Now this pit stop or this caution doesn't really do a lot to change the complexity of this race because we're about 15 laps away from what would be the final stop, so I think you're going to see everybody at the front. Just stay out.
Old Greg Biffle will come in, I bet you.
You think?
weekly Gillette Young Guns Challenge. A lucky fan who correctly picks the top placing Gillette Young Gun each week wins $5,000. Log on to GilletteYoungGuns.com for details as you get a look at how they're running now. And enter for a chance to win. Gillette Young Gun Challenge brought to you by M3 Power, the world's best shave. Tony Stewart leading, Kurt Busch, Scott Pruitt on lap 56 under caution. Let's get a State Farm safety report and check in with Jeff Hamm. Jeff?
Heat and fire are always a huge concern to racers. So whenever new technology can be introduced, it may help in these areas. Everyone is extremely excited. Oakley, working with our military to develop eyewear and boots for their special forces, found and developed a new product called CarbonX. They've now introduced that product into NASCAR in the forms of underwear, gloves, and safety shoes. In a demonstration earlier today, a sample of CarbonX and a leading fire-resistant material that is commonly used was dipped in a fuel and ignited. CarbonX is the black material on the left. In a few seconds, the commonly used material shrinks and crumbles. CarbonX maintains its integrity. Progress and driver safety marches on. CarbonX, a new material developed for the military, now used in NASCAR to keep our drivers safer and more comfortable.
All right, thank you, Jeff Hammond. Looking a little like G.I. Joe there. Let's rejoin Daryl, Larry, and Mike.
And Daryl, fire has to be the biggest fear any driver has in any given racetrack.
Oh, yeah, because all you can think about is, look how you're strapped in these race cars, and can I get out? That's the question.
Nomex is the material we've used for years, and that, too, was developed for military pilots several decades ago. Dick Bergman.
Well, Jimmy Johnson's transmission has been fixed, and believe it or not, the same guy that fixed Robbie Gordon's transmission also fixed Johnson's transmission. Travis Blazer climbed into the car, knew just what to do to fix that transmission, got it all squared away, and Johnson's back out on the racetrack. However, Johnson has been told, shift quickly, don't shift slowly. By the way, the guy that fixed the transmission is wearing a Robbie Gordon uniform, even though he doesn't work for Gordon. He works for the transmission company. Mike?
And the good news, that caution came at a timely time for Jimmy Johnson because he's still on the lead lap.
Well, you know what? Not all the road course specialists are in the cars.
That's a good point.
Tony Stewart's going to lead him down for this restart to complete 57 laps. Kurt Busch, Scott Pruitt, and Boris Senn are their shadows in third and fourth place. Ryan Newman, Jeff Burton, Joe Nemechek, Terry Labonte, Matt Kenseth, and Jamie McMurray, the top 10. Kenny Schrader got the free pass, so we now have 35 lead lap cars with Jeff and Robbie Gordon a lap down. Casey Kane three laps back, and Mike Bliss further along with Kyle Busch and Dale Earnhardt Jr. The only car in the garage is Tom Hubert, who came out here to drive Kurt Shelmerdine's Ford. They've been selling sponsorship, auctioning it off on eBay, and started the race here today, but ended early.
Tell you what, we're looking at Joe Nemechek in that Army 01 car. That's another car that's having a good run today. He's sitting back there right behind Jeff Burton in the 31 we talked about earlier, but Joe's back in the seventh spot. I talked to him this morning. A lot of debate about what to do to that race car, not knowing if the sun was going to come out. Car's pretty solid right now.
And it has been the last number of weeks. That car just has been real consistent, and it's really paying off for Joe. He's moving up in the points.
Nemechek, teammates to Scott Riggs and to the man in the fourth place car, Boris Senn. Matt Kenseth with Jamie McMurray right on his bumper, but Kenseth looking poised for a top 10 finish here, Steve.
Hey, Mike, how about the job Matt Kenseth is doing? He started 24th. He's up into the ninth position. He last pitted on lap 34. He said moments ago that his car has been tight when he turns to the left. But this is interesting. The longer he runs, the more fuel burns off, the easier it is to turn.
Well, it's just adding more weight to those front tires. As the fuel comes out of the back, it'll add a little nose weight, put a little grip in the front tires.
Now, earlier we talked about three cars who started in the back. Kevin Harvick is now in 13th place, Greg Biffle in 26th. But Casey Mears, who also started in the back, is 11th.
Well, he started right back there with Greg Biffle, and I've been trying my best to figure out how those guys could overcome starting back there. Jimmy Elliott's a crew chief. He figured it out. One, they've got a car that goes quite a ways on fuel. He started at the rear. When we had that caution back on lap two, he came to pit road at lap four, four tires, filled it up with fuel. What he did then, he was one of the first cars to pit when we got in the green flag pit stops at lap 27, which is 83 laps to go. He's moved himself almost up into the top 10. What Jim Elliott will have to do now, he'll have to pit about lap 69, which is about 11 or 12 laps from now. That's 43 laps when he pitted, 42 to go to the end of the race. He can do it on two stops. One more stop from here.
Yes, he can. Oh, big trouble.
Big mess.
Kyle Petty.
Caution
gets away,
out.
But two cars are still parked, and it is the four of P.J. Jones atop the 99 of Carl Edwards.
That's ugly right there.
Oh, yeah.
More cars out. There he goes. Carl, feel it out. You might have to take it to the garage there, bud.
Yeah, I got a feeling you have to take that one to the garage, boys.
We're going to be fine. Somebody just drove me into it, man.
Well, let's see. Did somebody drive Carl Edwards into it? There's the first hit. Who's that sliding in on the inside? Was P.J. Jones into Kyle Petty. And
Ryan
the 33.
Simo, yeah, and the 33.
Yeah.
Drove him right into it.
Yeah, Brian Simo pushed Edwards into the crash.
I think it to Brian healed when he should have been towing.
Clear.
Ron Fellows again gets around the outside of it. Oof. But it all started when P.J. Jones took it real hard into turn 11 on the inside of Kyle Petty.
And that's a shame, Carl Edwards, because he's making his first start out here. He qualified back in about 23rd. He was in Milwaukee racing last night, finished 14th, and he was in the top 20.
And the four cars attempt to get into the top 35. Not looking good here.
Thoughts are with you, Jack Noether, battling cancer, part of our technical team. He's been hospitalized. We certainly wish him the best, want him to know we're thinking of him. Many people are here on our Fox crew. Tony Stewart currently leading at lap 60, so we have 50 to go under caution. Time for a Visa race break. Of course, Gibbs Racing has yet to win a race this year. Tony Gibbs trying to end that. Earlier today, Hendrick Motorsports having some success and some problems. This is a points leader, Jimmy Johnson, who rapidly fell back, Jeff, because of transmission problems.
Yeah, they were having trouble with the shifters. We see his teammate right here, Kyle Busch. They went behind the wall to try to work on their transmission, and here comes Jeff Gordon. He also had a problem with the car not wanting to shift properly, but they went up underneath the car, went and got some help from the transmission guys. They all worked together, and they were able to effectively make repairs without having to change the transmission, which is a huge, huge game for these teams.
And Jeff Gordon, who led 32 laps earlier, then was a lap down, just got the free pass on that last caution, so he's back on the lead lap. Let's check out the Wendy's race menu here. Saturday baseball, the Braves and Phillies, Marlins and Mets, and then some of you will see the Dodgers and Diamondbacks from Dodger Stadium, the Rangers and the Mariners. Saturday baseball on Fox. And of course the All-Star game on Fox as well coming up here in mid-July. And on pit road is Jeff Gordon.
Yeah, when you take a look right now, it looks like they're working to make some more repairs and make some kind of adjustment to the 24 car. A little indecision right there. You also see the points lead right there. Jimmy Johnson, he's on pit road or coming back off pit road. Let's see, he's going to make a stop here and get himself four tires. Both these guys are very, you know, way back in the pack, so why not go ahead and make an adjustment to your car now?
And you were talking about some of the transmission problems. Is it something common thread in this race with Hendrick Motorsports?
Well, not so much with Hendrick Motorsports, maybe the type of transmission. We saw Robbie Gordon had problems. They've been working on his car. They've got it working like it's supposed to. So it's like a little malfunction inside the shifter itself.
This has been a Visa race break, and we'll continue here from Sonoma. You're watching NASCAR on Fox. Good to have you along.
Green, Tony Stewart the leader from Kurt Busch, Scott Pruitt, Boris Sett, and Ryan Newman. Now Jeff Gordon got the free pass that time, but because it takes so long to go around here, Gordon's crossing the start-finish line now as the field is about two-thirds of a lap ahead of him. So he is back on the lead lap, but our pole sitter is well back of the leader. We'll give you an interval after they complete a lap or two here under Green.
See Carl Edwards in the 99, comes in here fourth in points. He's back out on the racetrack. Yeah, what Jeff Gordon, the 24 car, needs right now is a caution to get caught back up to the field.
Look at, okay, here's Kurt Busch and Scott Pruitt.
nose to tail. Pruitt putting the pressure on. I was looking at turn 11 where Ricky Rudd and Sterling Marlin went in there side by side. They've done that about 12 times today over the course of 63 laps.
As good a car as Pruitt had here last year, Larry, and he's running third right now, I wouldn't count him out, I can tell you that. And of course, here goes our...
There's the caution right there that Jeff Gordon needed. We are on a full course caution, so he would be able to catch up those 51 seconds that he was behind. But again, we're about 7 to 10 laps away from our leaders, Tony Stewart, Kurt Busch, and the 97, Scott Pruitt, making that last final pit stop.
Turn 9 is the last corner of the S's. That is where the debris is. That puts us under this caution flag. While we're under caution, let's talk a little about transmissions. It used to be that when you went to a track, Darrell, with a special road race transmission, whether it was Riverside, California, or Watkins Glen, New York, it was a Jericho transmission, much like the one that Jeff Hammond showed us, that cutaway transmission. But now, it's not just Jericho. There's a lot of different people in this game.
Yeah, the Jericho, what they did, it was a straight-cut gear transmission with no synchronizers, had dog rings. You could shift it without the clutch. That was the first version of a road course transmission. What's happened through the years, though, is people have started to make deviations of that, variations of that Jericho. Moving the shifter around is the big thing.
So, Larry, what are the Hendrick cars running here?
Well, they're running Mid-Valley Engineering transmissions, but let me add one other thing, reason some teams may be playing with transmissions. Darrell talked earlier in the broadcast about the gear and transmission rule. Pretty much NASCAR has locked these guys into the rear-end gear that they have to run. Now, on the transmissions, they basically said no more overdrive. We would always run overdrive here because third is one-to-one, and that's where you spend the most time. So because of the gear and transmission rule, working through some new ratios, that's why teams like Dale Earnhardt Jr., Hendrick Motorsports may also be playing with other brands.
The Roush cars, we're told, are running the Jericho transmission. We'll check on the Gibbs camp when we come back. 64 laps complete in the Dodge Save Mart 350 on Fox. Welcome back to Infineon Raceway at Sonoma, California. Tony Stewart leading. The Joe Gibbs cars do run the Jericho transmissions. Jerry Hemmingson's company out of Concord, North Carolina. But they have a fellow in their gear shop, Slick Poston, who modifies those transmissions for Stewart and Bobby Labonte. Greg Biffle back in the pits. And the transmission Jeff showed us was not a Jericho, but a Tex Powell, a Tex Racing transmission, an SR1, a single rail type transmission version 1. So a lot of different transmission technology in use here for the road course.
Everybody took something that wasn't broken and worked on it till it was.
And we're seeing a lot of guys on pit road. You see the 48 car there just topping off with fuel. What these guys may be banking on with 45 laps to go, and a lot of these cars were at the rear of the field, the rear of the pack of the lead lap cars. If you could get enough cautions, you maybe can make it from here without stopping again. We know most of our leaders are going to be on pit road in the next 5 to 8 laps.
Three of the 400 cars stop under this caution flag. Answer to our most recent singular virtual crew chief question. Who has the best chance of making the chase? Dale Jarrett gets the fans' vote over Matt Kenseth and Dale Earnhardt Jr.
And the biggest thing, a lot of these cars that are well outside of the 400-point window, they're dependent on their race team having good runs, but they're dependent on Jimmy Johnson, Greg Biffle having problems, as Biffle had problems in Pocono, Jimmy Johnson here today.
Talking about transmission problems.
Because it's 400 points to the leader after Richmond September, whoever that may be. This week on Speed Channel, the relaunch of NASCAR Nation. It's all new. Off track, in depth, NASCAR beyond the fast lane, and it premieres this week exclusively on Speed Channel. If your cable provider doesn't get Speed Channel, call 1-888-22-SPEED.
And that's going to be a cool show. We see what these guys do at the racetrack every Sunday. This is going to show you what these guys do maybe Monday through Thursday.
You know, one thing that's happened here, though, Robbie Gordon gets his lap back here. They just released him to go around the racetrack, and the pace car is coming into turn 11 to restart the race. With these single-file restarts, they need to release that guy sooner so he can get caught up to the rear of the field.
But the bottom line is they're back on the lead lap, and
I'm
sure they're very thankful for it.
He's back on the lead half lap.
There you go.
Okay, well wishes to Chuck Mills and Mark Hall. Chuck's our lead cameraman and has been covering NASCAR almost since live television on NASCAR.
And Mark Hall, one of our video editors.
We'll say hello to our old buddy Van Colley, too. He's back in the hospital. Wish him well.
Sorry to hear that.
Get well, Van.
65 complete, 45 to go. Tony Stewart, once Jeff Gordon gave way after leading the first 32 laps, it's pretty much been Stewart in charge.
I believe that 97 car, though, is lurking right there behind him. I'm not sure that he's done yet. In the 39, when in that white car.
And who would have thought that Ryan Newman might have his best chance to win his first race of the year at a road course?
Been solid all day long. Look at the race car. I don't really see a mark on it. He stayed good and clean.
And we're riding with Jeff Burton down into turn four, and this is perhaps Jeff Burton's best run of this season so far.
Well, we can talk about Tony Stewart, we can talk about Kurt Busch, Scott Pruett, but in about 5 to 6 laps, these guys are going to be on pit road. It's going to be so critical. Remember, no mistakes. Remember all the drivers that got caught speeding on that last green flag stop? That pretty much would take you out of this race.
What is it about curb hopping that just gets everybody up off their chair?
I mean,
it looks worse than it is, isn't it, Darrell?
It doesn't feel that bad in the car either. And the things will go, I mean, they go 3 or 4 feet up in the air off the ground. Look like they're going to turn over. But that big old sway bar and the shocks, it just jerks the wheels right off the ground and gets you up in the air. Not so sure that's not what happened to Jimmy Johnson when he jammed his gears.
Let's check with Matt.
And Jeff Gordon moments ago said there's something amiss with the transmission again. It's stuck in third. He couldn't get it out. And then he came back out and said, all right, now it's out. So problems continue for the 24 Gordon with transmission issues.
I am just shocked, Larry, that even the 48 and the 24 and Robbie Gordon, they've all been able to fix what was wrong with their transmission. So that tells you it's not an internal thing, it's a shifter thing, that the shifters are locking up in two gears.
And especially how early they all had transmission problems.
Now, Jimmy Johnson back in 22nd position, Jeff Gordon in 34th, another uncharacteristic off day for the Hendrick team due to mechanical difficulties.
I think that Jimmy Johnson and them staying out, though, you know, they were going to the garage.
Right.
Stayed out, rode around, got a caution, got the thing fixed. That may not be too bad of a deal, Larry.
No, because he's about to crack the top 20. And remember, he was one of those cars that pitted just a few laps ago. We know he can either make it to the end or possibly just a shot of fuel near the end.
Serial scoring on the lowest Chevrolet. He's been as low as 42nd in this race. We started 43. Having a look underneath Dale Jarrett.
And quite honestly, that's what that team is so good at. Taking a car that's off, taking a car with a problem, and bringing it home with a great finish.
Stewart slides it around at the top of the hill, turn 3A, and he is opening some distance on Kurt Busch. It's now 1.5 seconds.
You can see all these lead cars here sliding around. It's because they're on pretty old tires right now, and they're looking very forward to this pit stop in a handful of laps.
Let's ride along and listen with Boris here a bit. Jimmy Johnson around and nobody hits him.
Watch your traffic here, Jimmy. You just fired up if you can. Chin's out, Jimmy. Caution's out.
Caution is out. I'm sure some of those leaders.
He's got a tire down, I think. I think his left rear's down.
We got a flat tire right now.
See, Barr said, I was just about to say, if any of those leaders were heads up, if they could have got to pit road before that caution came out, then this is pretty much a free pit stop, and we feel like all these teams can make it from
here.
Big heads up by Frankie Stoddard in that group.
Sure we made it in.
You heard him ask, are you sure we made it in past the commit line before they closed pit road?
Four tires and fuel, I got no way of knowing. You should have.
They'll let him know.
Dick?
Indeed, Frank Stoddard had earlier been urging Boris Head to try to get by Scott Pruett before this caution flag came on. Meanwhile, Pruett has just been told that he needs to come in as soon as he can. Pruett will pit on the next lap. Said done with his stuff.
Well, a lot of these guys, they have to pit. They're just about out of fuel.
And the spotters really can't help. They're not in position to see if the driver got past the commit cones before the caution flag waved.
It's down to turn seven right here. Jimmy's underneath the Dale Jarrett. Coming off the corner, they make contact, more contact. I don't think Dale was real happy with Jimmy Johnson trying to force his way by.
Now here's the pit entrance on the right of your screen.
And the commit line is right there, basically at the end of the wall right there.
And you can see Morris is into the pits.
Now what NASCAR will do, if there is any question, is they will take the time code of this video and sync it up with the time code of the caution flag waving.
As he went by, I saw a guy on the pit wall down there start to wave a yellow flag, so he was definitely in the pits.
Okay.
And what this will mean...
About 2-3 car lengths before that guy started waving the red flag.
What you said.
Yes, sir.
He will be able to stay out now. We feel like he can make it to the end. All of the other leaders, Tony Stewart, Kurt Busch, Scott Pruitt, Ryan Newman, Jeff Burton, they still have to come to pit road, whether it's under this caution or shortly after we go back to green.
So NASCAR is reviewing the video to assert that Boris said would have been on pit road prior to the caution flag waving or not. And they can sync up the video, the time code, to be able to do that definitively.
Well, here's the deal. 41 laps to go. If he made it to pit road before it was closed, it could be a race-winning move. If he was on pit road after it was closed, tail end of this field with basically 41 laps to go.
I think what you'll see, what I saw when he was coming by here a second ago, was a flagman on the outside of pit road here. Here he comes.
Oh, no.
No. Oh. The lights are flashing.
The lights were on.
And now the lights are off in his car and in his pits.
Because he's going to restart because of hitting too soon back about 36 or 37. It was close.
I saw the flagman. See that guy right on the side right there on the right of your screen?
On the lower right.
Yeah, he was waving the yellow when he went by, so I thought he might have made it in.
Now, with 40 laps to go, you're seeing all our leaders come to pit road for, I'm sure, that final stop. Steve.
Kurt Busch says he's tight to the left again, loose to the right. Jimmy Fenwick says down one on that right jack screw. Kurt Busch also wants a water and a towel. Matt.
This is going to be a slight air pressure adjustment for Tony Stewart, the leader in the 20 car. Jeff Gooch Patterson already has the second can as they're waiting for the changers to come around. Now he will insert that in the dry brake and get the rest of that can in. You can see he is shaking his head, meaning the car is full. Dick.
Scott Pruitt was running in the third spot before he pitted. This is exactly the lap that crew chief Lee McCall had determined they wanted to pit at any rate. No matter what, they were coming in right now. Pruitt with four tires on and fuel, but a lot of people beating him out of the pits. This is not a regular pit crew that he's got. This is a group of guys brought together for this race.
Pit road, a busy place with 36 cars still on the lead lap at the tail end of this race. Now, just in case there's any confusion, let's clear this up a little. The light, the commitment light, that fiber optic big planet there, Mars or whatever they call it, that Whelan Engineering has built, that is triggered at the same instant that all the caution lights around the track are triggered and NASCAR triggers scoring to score the cars at the last loop they pass to determine the caution flag order. The flaggers around the track, they're in radio control with the tower. They are told when the caution is out to issue the flag, but it is the caution lights that are controlling and not the individual flaggers around the course.
It appeared by when that came on, the only guys that maybe could have made it without, with it being still open, was probably our couple of leaders, Tony Stewart and Kurt Busch.
So here's Boris Sett again, and you'll see on the upper left.
Yeah, look right over here. There's a light as he's going by, as he's coming to it, actually. Yeah. There you are. It's right here, and it's flashing, and that tells you that the pits are closed.
And that's well before the commit line.
And you heard Frank Stoddard, his crew chief, on the radio. Did we make it? Did we make it? Somebody tell me, did we make it? And Boris was stopped in the pit before Frank could get an answer, so they fired the four tires on it because their bed was made.
It was a gamble. It was a close gamble, and it almost paid off for that crew.
But now I tell you who also has gambled, though. We saw him just a second ago. He's going to be the man leading this race right now. Rusty Wallace in the two car just had a so-so day. But remember, he was one of those cars like Elliott Sadler, Dale Jarrett in 88 and 38 that pitted back on lap 65 with 45 to go. Enough cautions, these guys can probably make it to the end. But just remember, a year ago, Rusty Wallace came up about a half a lap shy on fuel and ran out of gas.
And also remember, they had a fueling problem and they're from one of their pit stops. So is it full of fuel?
That's right. A lot of questions to be answered here over the final 40 laps in Sonoma. Rusty Wallace, your leader. You're watching NASCAR on Fox.
Nextel Cup Racing on Fox is brought to you by UPS. We're going to race the truck. People love the truck. UPS, the official delivery company of NASCAR, delivers the chance to win four tickets to next year's Daytona 500. Go to foxsports.com, keyword UPS. 39 laps to go. Rusty Wallace in front. We're getting ready to go green.
So the question, Chris, will be who can make it on fuel and who has issues. Ricky Rudd makes a run inside Elliott Sadler. Nothing there. Third place as they climb the hill. Under the bridge and head up toward two.
I know Russell saying, I don't need no stinking rocking chair. I'm going to lead this race a while.
Now, we do need to make a note that back in the field a little bit, Kurt Busch in the 97, that Jimmy Finning crew, as well as Ryan Newman, the 12 car, they beat Tony Stewart off pit road on that pit stop.
So they are 11th and 12th on this restart.
There's Jimmy Finning, crew chief for Kurt Busch. Been solid all weekend long. There's Kurt Busch in the 97 going by Scott Riggs in the 10.
10th place. Kurt really had to jump that curb to have enough room coming out of 3A.
Yeah, here comes Biffle, should be somewhere in there. He is
riding with Jeff Burton,
and he's in the 15th position right now.
And I'm telling you, I know they've been in a hole all day long, but a couple of more cautions, he could make it to the finish.
Digging their way out.
Working it.
38 laps to go.
One of my all-time favorite sayings, it ain't over till it's over.
Sadler and Rudd underneath Dale Jarrett, whose car wounded from contact. Oh, and a little bit of bump there between the eight cars.
It's the owner's worst nightmare right there.
Well, Dale's been beating around quite a bit today. He and Jimmy Johnson had a little go of it, he and Carl Edwards. So he's had a few people take shots at him.
Tell you what, Rusty Wallace in the two, he's loving watching these guys run side by side, Dale Jarrett, Elliott Sadler, because he just continues to stretch it out right now.
Now we said Jarrett's, he's had a couple of bumps and scrapes, but he's the second place car. Rudd inside, bump, bump. One on course, one off.
But yep. You got to give right there.
He had to.
Elliott Sadler's playing chicken with the wall.
Somebody had to give, and it was the 38.
Hit, baby, hit your marks.
And look, Rudd was the faster car.
Oh, yeah, he had position.
And pulls away from Sadler.
He had track position. Elliott had apron position.
Right. And if he'd stayed out there, he would have had garage position.
Exactly. Tow truck.
Meanwhile, Tony's in 10th place. And after the pit stop, Kurt Busch out ahead of him, as you've heard. Tony now 10th, Marlin 11th, Newman 12th, and Biffle 13th.
Tell you another car that's painted himself out of a box. That 32 car, Ron Fellows, the Tide car right now, started dead last on the field. We're riding with him now. Crashed late in the practice yesterday. They repaired this race car. He pitted back on lap 65, got that track position. He's banging on the top five right now.
And the car he is right up and under is Jeremy Mayfield. They're in fifth place, Steve.
And a gamble by that race team, Mike. Slugger Labby, the crew chief on the 19, is telling Jeremy Mayfield, save, save, save. He's saying use third gear instead of second if you can. Bobby Labonte spins on the racetrack.
What he's telling him, short shift. Don't rev the engine. Second, third, get in a high and save some fuel.
No caution for Bobby Labonte's single car spin.
Bobby Labonte can have more luck, bad luck at the end of a race than anybody I think I know. Continually.
Rusty Wallace out front,
Fox Sports gave him a rocking chair this morning in pre-race. I think, Dick, we were a little premature.
Yeah, I think so, because Rusty is rocking, and he is very, very good on these road courses. He last pitted on lap 66, Mike, and I just talked to his crew chief, Larry Carter, and asked him if he was going to pit again, and he said no. Rusty, good to go all the way to the end. He, however, is conserving fuel to the point that he is cutting the engine out, going downhill, trying to save all the gas he can.
Well, once again, Dick, I talked about it a little while ago when Rusty stayed out. Is last year, when they took the white flag, he was running fourth. When they came back around, there was no Rusty. He ran out of fuel, finished 28th. That was 81 points different. He told us, Darrell, he said, I know it was only one race, but that's probably was the Achilles heel, me not making the chase for the championship.
And I tell you, he doesn't historically get great gas mileage. And so if they're cutting it close, boy, it's going to be a nail biter.
Right. Drivers that are on and off the throttle a lot. We saw Borisette doing it to feather the throttle, but drivers that jump on and off it on a road course, you're right, they're going to be in the pit sooner for fuel.
And when you've got a 2.5 second lead, you certainly can work a little harder conserving fuel.
Jimmy Johnson, our Nextel Cup leader, still on the lead lap, but back at 36th, and reports of perhaps more transmission trouble for the Lowe's Chevy. That would put Greg Biffle into the points lead. Biffle right now is 13th, Johnson 36th in this race.
How about that, though? As of right now, Rusty Wallace leading this race would be fourth in the points.
Youth is not served. Fine drivers need to age too. And here are our first three. Average age, Dan Gurney's old car number, 48.
Can't beat Sparrows, baby.
There we were in pre-race. You see those right feet? They've gotten pretty heavy since that tour in the rocking chair.
The question is Rusty still in the rocking chair?
Welcome back to Infineon Raceway. Sears Point, Sonoma, California. As you watch race leader Rusty Wallace from our Goodyear aerial coverage, the Goodyear Airships, a great site for decades at sporting events around America. Don't forget to join the Goodyear Garage by logging on to GoodyearGarage.com. And Rusty's lead is shrinking. Ricky Rudd just ran his fastest lap of the race. Dale Jarrett in third, all three drivers 48 years of age. And among them, only Rusty showing any sign of let-up. This is his final season in Nextel Cup. But Ricky Rudd is still hungry for wins. He has two here at Infineon.
Where is Sterling going, guys?
Well, he was spun out down there, coming off turn 10.
Speaking of 48-year-olds, there's another one. Sterling Marlin having a little trouble. Let's see what happened to Sterling.
Coming down to turn 10 here, or 11, I mean. Could he have gotten a little help?
Hard to say.
I believe that was Scott Pruitt, the 39 car that was actually right behind him. But I think the biggest question is we watch Rusty Wallace in the 2, Ricky Rudd in the 21. Is Ricky's car that much better than Rusty's? He's really chopping the lead down. Or how much is Rusty conserving?
Jeff Gordon started on the pole. He led the first 32 laps. Tony Stewart got out front for a lap and then came out to lead a total of 27 today. Now, on this last restart, Stewart's Home Depot number 20 restarted 14th. Here he battles Elliott Sadler and takes away the fourth position. He's trying to get back to the front. Matt, what are his chances?
Chances look pretty good, Mike. He just got by the 38 of Elliott Sadler, who says they are good to go on fuel. Stewart told by Greg Zipidelli before the restart, look, we've got a great race car, be patient. Stewart said, don't worry, I'll keep the ears on the dog. He is quickly moving back up through it. You talk about the 88's good to go on fuel. Stewart is good to go even if we get a green, white, checker finish.
You know, talk about Elliott Sadler in that 38 M&M's car. That's another car that was in a box when this race started. Third in the points coming into this race. Spun qualifying, started back there with Greg Biffle. Here he's sitting there in the top five.
And, you know, I saw him do such a smart thing. Tony Stewart's faster than he is. He pulled over and let Tony go. Didn't race him. Didn't take a chance on knocking himself out of the race.
There'll be plenty of time for that later.
Oh, yeah, but he's sitting up there in third in the points, and this could be a big points day for him.
So Sadler, the youngest of the leaders at 30. As here is Ricky Rudd, who is now closed to within less than half a second on Rusty Wallace. He's going to dive bomb him at turn 11, try to get right to his bumper. Smooth on the throttle, you hear Ricky Rudd. Vic Bergman.
It's an opportunity to get closer to the sport and their drivers through Team Ford Racing. Pit Tours on Race Day, a monthly racing magazine inside the oval, special seating at otherwise sold-out events, and discounts on dozens of racing products and services. To join, log on to teamfordracing.com. Ford, built for the road ahead.
Ricky Rudd, 4/10 off of Rusty Wallace, with 29 laps to go, and Rudd closes again. And now he really begins to put the pressure on. But these are two of NASCAR's all-time best road racers going at it here for the lead.
And they have two totally different styles, trust me. Rusty's in there using both feet, stomping them pedals. Ricky's right behind him doing that heel and toe thing, tap dancing his way right to the lead.
And this is what we talked about at the top of the show, Darrell. Rusty's driving it like he stole it. Ricky Rudd is finessing his car around the course.
But both of them are driving like guys that want to get a win. And there goes Ricky Rudd, the 21 car, turn 11. He's going to take the lead.
Clear. Keep digging, baby. Keep digging.
The last time Ricky Rudd won a race was here in 2002, driving this very chassis that he has under him right now.
Of the three 48-year-olds at the front, Rudd has had the longest victory drought.
And DW talked about it in the pre-race. Ricky Rudd has still not made a solid statement about what his future plans are.
No, he hadn't. And of course, if he wins today, then he'll drive for five more years.
You bet.
Oh, at least.
At least. And right now, I don't see anything to keep him from it. The car looks excellent going around the racetrack, assuming they're good on fuel.
Well, he could look in his rearview mirror. He could see that orange car coming right there. Tony Stewart, that 20 car, who's moved within about 3 seconds of our leader right now.
Yeah, there are only two cars on the track that are appreciably faster than Ricky Rudd, and that's Tony Stewart in third and Kurt Busch in fifth.
Well, you got to believe Stewart's sitting back there in pretty good shape, that he should be able to chase these guys down, but he's got to do it first.
And the one great unknown is, are they getting all there is to get out of that race car? We'll see what happens if push comes to shove.
As long as they get all the fuel.
Ricky Rudd, 48 years old, leading at this point. Joe Nemechek spinning here with 25 laps to go, and a caution has come out.
No caution right now. He spun all the way around down in turn 11, the 01 car of Joe Nemechek. We're riding with him right now. He's catching gears, but he lost a lot of spots right now and fell all the way back into about 30th position.
We saw Kurt Busch moments ago as well make a nice save and not lose any position on the track, currently running in the top five. But let's talk about Ricky Rudd. 107 races since his last Cup win, as Larry McReynolds pointed out. 768th consecutive Nextel Cup race, a streak that started way back in 1981. So he's been an Iron Man of sorts.
He has definitely been an Iron Man, and he is very professional when it comes to road racing. I mean, Ricky has been long considered one of the top road racers in NASCAR, and he does a tremendous job. He being out front right now with this car, he's got confidence in. Larry McReynolds talked about it. They went over to Robert Yates Racing and bought this chassis, and Fatback McSwain, his crew chief, you hear him, they're giving out lap times right now to Ricky to give him an idea what Tony Stewart is doing. But he is really doing a good job right now in this 21 car.
And the question with 24 laps to go, does he have enough fuel to make it? Let's check in with Dick Bergman. Dick?
Well, that's a very good question. I talked to his crew chief, Fatback McSwain, just a few moments ago, Chris, and Fatback said they really need some caution flags. Asked him if he thought he could make it. He put his two fingers together like ever so close, but he doesn't think he can. This is a very unique race car. Larry McReynolds told you that this is the car he won with a couple of years ago driving for Robert Yates. The car got sold back to the Wood Brothers, and they moved the seat over. Ricky Rudd sits closer to the center of this race car, gives him a bit better balance. You don't want too much weight on one side or the other. And Joe Nemechek today is running with some real problems. Last week, driving his motorcycle, Nemechek caught a rut and dumped the bike. His right hand is all swollen up. He didn't break any bones in the right hand, but he certainly did sprain it. He has been
clear.
To doctors. He has been to all sorts of people to try to help him out to get that right hand squared away. That's the shifting hand, also obviously used on the steering wheel.
And he has spun again, Dick, as we just saw on the onboard right there. That first spin, Nemechek was running 20th, and just one quick spin put him all the way back to 36th.
And the shifter issue that some of these guys have been dealing with today, the transmission problems, that's why they moved all the shifting rods off of the left-hand side of the transmission up on top so the driver could move the seat over closer to the transmission tunnel.
And, by the way, that was just a replay of Nemechek's spin earlier. That did not bring out a caution. So he has spun once, and it took him from 20th to 36th place.
I'm glad of that.
I am
thought,
too.
Man, that's two perfect spins I ever saw.
Identical place, identical spin.
Yeah.
Now, Kevin Harvick got back up into the top 10 for a while today after having to start this race at the tail end. But now that Goodwrench Chevrolet is falling back quite a bit. He's at 35th. Nemechek's going to make the pass here.
And the reason he had to start at the rear of the field is when they took the valve covers off that engine yesterday after practice, they found a valve spring that was broken, so they decided to change the engine. The reason he had to go to the rear.
I was looking at his left rear tire. It's got been rubbed on pretty hard. I thought he may have a tire going down, but it appears to be okay.
You know, as we go back and look at Ricky Rudd in the 21 car leading this race with 22 laps to go, remember, he was on pit road with 45 to go. Dick Bergeron has talked to Michael Fatback McSwain. Can they make it? Can they not make it? You know, the pace is slowing down, but you know what, DW? If I'm this 21 car, I'm going to run it till there's no fuel, because we're looking at a race team has no top fives, only two top 10 finishes, but the big picture, little borderline on the owner points, their 33rd and owner points, so they don't need to flirt with disaster there. But you know what? This race team, they need to win a race.
This is a feel-good run right here. Feels good to be up front having people chase you.
But Larry, the bad news is the lap counter and the timing chart, which shows Tony Stewart is catching Ricky about 6-tenths of a second a lap, which means that in three laps, Stewart's going to be there for the lead.
Okay, second place wouldn't be bad for this race.
Not bad at all. Our final singular virtual crew chief question of the day. Which race had the best finish this year? Daytona, Atlanta, or Lowe's Motor Speedway in Charlotte? Well, could be here as well. But to vote, text the message crew to 191 on your singular phone or go to foxsports.com.
All I know is almost all of them have been good this year so far. They've all been exciting.
We have had some pretty great finishes. Can Ricky Rudd hold off Tony Stewart? Stay tuned to NASCAR on Fox.
Ricky Rudd, your leader currently. But let's check out the Nextel Cup points as they stand to the moment. This is with just 19 laps remaining in this race. And you see, Jeff Hammond, that Greg Biffle would move in front of Jimmy Johnson. Biffle has not led in points this year, even though he has 5 victories.
But, Chris, I want to add one thing. You see how it is right now. We still have 19 laps to go. At this racetrack, anything can happen all the way down to the final lap. So this may be the way it is now. We've got to wait to the end of this race to see exactly where everybody shakes out.
In case you joined us late, Dale Earnhardt Jr. is going the wrong way in points. A brush with the zero car there on
Mike
lap
Bliss.
Three with Mike Bliss. Thank you for helping out. He went 22 laps down. He was okay back in the race, but certainly a non-factor. Now, Hendrick Motorsports, some problems with transmissions today.
Had a lot of problems with the transmission. Jimmy Johnson, Jeff Gordon, as well as Kyle Busch, all of them had problems today. They've been able to make repairs and carry on, but they've been troubled all day long. So it hasn't been a very smooth day for Hendrick Motorsports when it comes to transmission.
Meanwhile, a throttle that got stuck at Casey Kane paying the price of the 9 car. That's Brian Vickers in the 25, bringing out one of the cautions. And on lap 69 in turn 7, that's Jimmy Johnson having some trouble after contact with Dale Jarrett, affecting the points leader, obviously.
Affecting the points leader. Here we see right now two veteran road racers. Ricky Rudd goes inside of Rusty Wallace and takes the lead. And he has taken the Wood Brothers number 21 Ford
to the front.
Still, Jeff Gordon has led the most laps today, 32, followed by Tony Stewart. But let's take a look at where the points leaders coming in are running currently. You see where Kurt Busch would be, where he's running and where he is in points. This is coming into the race as Jeff Gordon. And now, where they currently stand, as you see the change in points, and Jimmy Johnson would drop to second. Kurt Busch would jump up to fourth. So these are major leaps. Jeff Gordon would move up one notch.
Yeah, you can see again how everything can get turned upside down when it comes to road course racing. It's very unpredictable. A lot of times you just can't figure it out from corner to corner who's where.
Tony Stewart chasing Ricky Rudd. Mike, with 17 laps to go, things may be tightening a bit.
Stewart's been consistently quicker than Rudd. He's running him down and has plenty of time. Rudd driving for the Wood Brothers, who used to dominate at Riverside International Raceway outside Los Angeles with Dan Gurney in a car numbered 121. Their last road course win, David Pearson at Riverside in 1977. The Wood Brothers haven't been to Victory Lane since Bristol in 2001 with Elliott Sadler. Rudd trying to bring them back there.
I tell you, the guy that's been doing a great job getting himself back in the race is Jeff Gordon. Oh, there's our buddy Boris.
Boris off course? Of course.
And Boris had just worked
all right,
himself.
Let's regroup, get it back.
Backed up into the 14th position. Remember, still trying to overcome that pitting too soon penalty not that many laps ago.
Cross turn seven here, and he just gets in a little hot, gets under, trying to get under Biffle, got in a little hot, ran her off the track.
Now, I'm joking about Boris being off court because he is exciting. He is the Mr. Excitement of road racing.
Tell you what, speaking of exciting, that orange dot back there is getting bigger and bigger with 16 laps to go. Tony Stewart in the 20, all over Ricky Rudd in the 21, but Dick Bergman, we're going to still ask the question, does the 21 have enough fuel?
And they don't know that right now. What they do know is that for about the last 15 laps or so, Ricky Rudd has heard in his ear every lap, his lap times and Tony Stewart's lap times, and invariably Stewart was faster. So he knew that Stewart was coming. Most recently, he heard in his ear, make him earn it. That's what he's going to have to do, make him earn it.
And they have a little bit of cushion right now on third place Kurt Busch in the 97 car. He's 5 seconds behind, so, you know, they have a little cushion here right now.
Yeah, but I think Tony's so much better, he's going to drive right by him going down into turn 11 here would be my guess. Ricky can try to hold him up for a while, but I think that Tony's
smart
so
move. Smart move. Rudd takes the line and says, Stewart, if you want me, you got to pass me on the outside.
Make him earn it.
That's right.
Go around me on the outside. Don't give up.
Hard to do in turn 11.
Not going to give it to you the easy way.
And that's really about the best passing opportunity you got for a whole lap.
Not if you take away the bottom lane.
And, of course, if you frustrate the guy trying to get around you, he might make a mistake. Tony knows he's faster. If he gets aggravated with Ricky because he can't get right around him like he thinks he should, who knows what might happen.
Rudd has, three official victories here at Sonoma. And there was another race where he was the first car to the flag, but because he bumped the leader out of the way on the white flag lap, they gave Rudd the black flag instead of the checker, but that was years ago.
And his nickname is Rooster. And you know how roosters are.
He's not going to give up easy, though. That's for sure.
I like what Fatback told him. Make him earn it. Make him go around you on the outside.
Well, I like that move into turn 11. That's a great defensive move. But now, Stewart is prepared for it. What will Rudd do this time?
Stewart goes to the outside again.
He's way up there this time.
Outside.
Now, look, Ricky gets better bite off the corner running that low.
Keep doing it, baby. Keep doing it.
14 to go this time.
I don't think you can do that 14 times in a row, but at least he's done it a couple.
Now it's up to Stewart. Where can I find another or a different advantage?
And how many times do we say this? It's one thing to catch a guy. It's something else to get around him.
And Darrell, about the only other place you can possibly do it, I won't say the only other place, but at the end of the short shoot into turn 7.
And the longer that he holds him up, the better it's going to be for Ricky, I'm telling you.
Sonoma Valley, Ricky Rudd. Through the chute, about 5 car lengths advantage over Tony Stewart. Makes the right-hand bend.
Now, what Tony should do, he's a little quicker. He ought to lay off of Ricky around turn 10 and get a really nice, strong run down into 11.
If
you can't, or if you can't beat him into the corner, run your normal line, get back on the throttle sooner, and beat him out of the corner.
But Darrell, the only place he looks like he really has an advantage right now is off turn 10 down to turn 11 from right here.
See, what he's trying to do is get a good strong run around 10 because he knows he's better right here in 11, but he can't get position.
Can Ricky Rudd hold off Tony Stewart to get his first win in 3 years? Hang on. 11 laps to go. Ricky Rudd has turned it up. His last lap, fractionally quicker than Tony Stewart. Rudd has a mirror full. He knows what he needs to do. Let's go to Tony's pit.
Mike, back on lap 96 as Tony Stewart drove by the pit. Greg Zabinelli told him his lap time, said, just be patient. You'll get him. Then Tony replied, I'm trying, but it's sort of hard when you're driving one-handed. Scott Deal, the car chief, Greg Zabinelli, the crew chief, looked at each other. Tony has said nothing all day on the radio about any possible transmission problem. They have no idea what he was talking about.
Crossover move by Stewart. Here he goes for the lead at turn 11.
He got in there just in time enough. Ricky in the 21 could not shut the door on him.
Ricky,
stay right after, buddy. Stay right after. They're saying he's got a shifter problem up here.
But Ricky gave him a lot of room getting down in there. But he knew Tony was pretty well committed.
Can Rudd battle back, or can Stewart get his first win of the year?
10 to go.
Pat?
You would have thought Tony Stewart just won the Daytona 500 the way he reacted on the radio, cheering and cheering his team on. Then Greg Zabinelli just said, keep in mind, we've got 10 laps to go.
Now, let's watch his pass right here, because he sets him up around 10. He's got the big run, Tony does, and Ricky knows it. Here comes Tony, and Ricky looks in his mirror and he says, uh-oh, he's coming hard and heavy, hot and heavy. I got to give him room. And of course, you see how Tony slid out. If Ricky hadn't given him room, he'd have made contact.
But the good run off turn 10 is what did it down in turn 11.
Right here, Rudd knows, he says, uh-oh, he's coming this time. I got to give him some room.
Nice crossover move by Stewart. And you saw Rudd double clutch at the turn to finally turn in and try to stay with Tony coming off.
Your first instinct is to block him. Then your brain kicks in and says, ooh, I don't think that's a good idea.
That was a group cheering him on. We've been talking about it a lot during the race. 30 races since this team went to victory lane.
And remember last week, when after the race, Stewart could not believe with fresh tires that he could not get back to Greg Biffle and win that race last week at Michigan. Best finish of the year. Atlanta, Carl Edwards got his first win. Jimmy Johnson got the payback at Lowe's Motor Speedway. Atlanta, best finish of the Fox half of the season so far.
We may have another one brewing here, though. 8.5 laps to go. Right now, Ricky Rudd has about a 6-second lead on third place Kurt Busch in the 97 car.
And what Rudd's got to worry about now is fuel. If he's got an issue with fuel, if he's afraid he's not going to make it, he needs to back off a little bit.
Speaking of fuel, there's the fuel window right there. Now, the difference is about 4 laps. Remember, Ricky pitted Ricky Rudd with 45 to go. Tony Stewart and Kurt Busch with 41 to go. Not a lot of fuel left in that 21 car.
And these are our estimates. These cars, of course, don't have fuel gauges. Dick?
Ricky Rudd is being told to take care of his fuel, Mike. He's also been told that there's a big, big distance between him and third place, so they want to make sure they don't run out of gas before the checkered flag drops.
Well, that's big picture racing, and as Larry told you, they're trying hard to stay in the top 35 of owner points to continue to get the qualifying exemption. But to be that close to the race leader with these few laps to go, saving fuel is a hard thing to do.
And you got to give a call to Ron Fellows. He's in the eighth position, started in the back. Uh-oh, we got the 15 around through the S's.
Coming backwards at a high rate of speed, Waltrip spins again. And
Clear the track right there. Y'all clear.
That's not worthy of a caution.
All clear.
Back to Ron Fellows. He's done a great job today. Got himself up there in the A spot. Right behind him is another guy that's done a good job, too.
The caution is out now.
I was mistaken. Michael Spinn kicked a lot of dirt and rocks out onto the racetrack, and there's one big piece of something.
Yeah, it looks like maybe a cone or a piece of brake duct or something.
Now, that caution.
Oh, one of those.
This caution is the good news, bad news
right
for
there.
Ricky Rudd.
It's here. All right.
Good. Clear on the track right there. Y'all clear.
fine. All clear.
Could
what do you mean,
good
Larry?
News, bad news for the 21 car, because the good news is these cautions could buy him enough laps to get to the end of this thing without running out of fuel. But it's going to put Kurt Busch in that 97 car right on his rear bumper, plus the rest of the lead lap cars.
I don't know, Darrell. If I got a shot to win my first race in 3 years, I'm not thinking about anybody behind me.
No. I think right now that this might even actually work out to help Ricky. Now, maybe that'll take the fuel issue out of it, and he can challenge Tony.
And cool those tires down.
Cool down a little bit and get another run at him.
Because there's not that much difference in their tires. Only four laps, just like the fuel window.
Like I said, there's a little rooster in that cage.
And, oh, by the way, here's the fourth place car. Rusty Wallace, been a while since he visited Victory Lane. Let's get an update, though, on fuel worries. Dick.
Well, Rusty Wallace just came on the radio as soon as that caution flag came out, Mike, and he said that he's running the car so hard that he's hurting his fuel mileage bad. The instant the caution flag came out, Fatback McSwain got on his radio and told Ricky Rudd, start conserving fuel right now. And but this is definitely the time to do it under caution.
And you can do that by putting it in high gear and lugging around here and don't touch that throttle. You got squirters in the carburetor. Every time you push that throttle down, it's squirting fuel in the engine.
And I want to go back to something Jeff Hammond talked about a long time ago. Remember, unlike any years here before, we potentially could have a green-white checkered, and that would definitely put these guys out of the fuel window.
That fuel window would slam shut on their fingers.
See how big that brake pedal is compared to the clutch? I mean, that tells you that he's a good heel and toe breaker, and he doesn't use the clutch much.
This is a guy we're riding with. He's loves seeing that caution because he was working his way back through the field. He's up to the 13th position, probably has one of the better cars, but remember, pitting too soon, back about lap 65, put him at the tail in the field, but he's been working his way back up through there and been off the racetrack a couple of times.
Nice run for Boris Sett today. Ron Fellows in eighth. Brian Simo hasn't had a lot of stock car experience. He's run Trans Am for quite a few seasons. Running in ninth, having a great run. And Scott Pruitt, who started up in the top 10 and 12th, just ahead of Boris. Here's Matt.
And Ron Fellows in the 32, having a great run, rebounding from his earlier troubles. But now, running in eighth, he's got to finish this race without any power steering. It's gone.
Well, he's going to have his hands full for these last seven laps. But, Darrell, we were just about to talk about the car behind him, Brian Simo in the 33 car, started in 22nd. This is only his fourth career start. He came out here and tested. This is a fourth Richard Childress car. The test was a disaster. They destroyed a car. And he's sharing a pit crew today with Dave Blaney. But here he's sitting in the top 10 in ninth position.
Car looks like he's used it up, too.
The cork's been
I'm a little bit worried for Fellows, though, because when you got to go left and right with no power steering, that's going to be a big chore right there.
The Major League All-Star Game, Tuesday night, July 12th on Fox in high definition. Always a treat. Well, pit road is open. Speaking of All-Stars, we talked about the Wood brothers. There's Leonard. He and Glenn and that whole crowd out of Stuart, Virginia, they were the experts of road racing for many years in NASCAR.
That man right there has seen it all. I mean, he has been to the top of the mountain. He's been to Indy. One sweetheart of a guy right there.
That's right.
Wood.
Ford brought the Wood brothers to Indy in the early 60s to pit Jimmy Clark because they thought the NASCAR boys had a leg up on pit stops over the IndyCar crowd.
LeMond.
And they were right.
Yep, they did.
I don't know about the NASCAR boys, but the Wood brothers did, that's for sure.
Yeah. Now let's go to the pits of the sixth place car for an update.
Mike down here in the 88 pit of Dale Jarrett. You've got so many Robert Yates Racing crew members. We're going to have to call roll. First off, Todd Parrott, you're down here talking to Billy Wilburn and Robert Yates. Where do you guys stand on fuel?
It's close, but I feel like with these caution flags, that's why we're all down here together. It's one big team here at Yates Racing today, and we're just down here trying to figure the best strategy we can, and we feel like we can make it. That's the only chance we had for a good, solid top 10 finish. The way pit strategy and stuff falls here, we just rolled the dice and gambled a little bit.
Real quick, Billy Wilburn, are you guys good to go on fuel?
I think we're good. We got Herbie the Love Bug. We're going to get it done.
He's going to get it done. Let's go to Chris Myers.
We're going to follow the love bug.
All right, it's all about fuel mileage and the love bug.
And well, and the other thing about Billy Wilburn, he's quite a gambler, so I'm not too surprised him making a run for the gas right now.
We heard about Rod Fellows, the road course specialist, running eighth currently.
Yeah, he has a problem with the power steering. And the one other thing it kind of adds to this situation is that these road race specialists, they like a smaller steering wheel, so it's going to be even harder for him to turn this thing right and left without a power assist.
On a side here, the record, all-time record for cars finishing on the lead lap is 33. We currently have 34. So depending upon how things finish, that could be something to watch for as well. Let's rejoin Daryl, Larry, and Mike.
I love what I'm hearing down on pit road, because what I'm hearing is, I don't think we have enough gas, but we're not stopping.
Well, I mean, you're seeing so many guys up there in that top five, like Tony Stewart, Ricky Rudd, Dale Jarrett. They want to win a race. They want an opportunity to win a race.
Yeah, you know? And you've rolled the dice. You've made your bed. It is what it is. If it makes it, it doesn't. If it doesn't, well, we had a pretty good day.
Yes, we did. They knew we were here.
They did.
So Tony Stewart trying to rebound from the disappointment, if second place can be called disappointing, at Michigan, a race he thought he should have won with fresher tires. Ricky Rudd trying to win for the first time in three seasons. Kurt Busch, the defending series champion. Rusty Wallace trying to close out his farewell tour with a couple of wins. Dale Jarrett and his teammate Elliott Sadler.
Good job for Jeremy today.
And we've gone to the dogs.
That dog right there won't hunt.
No, he won't.
No. Need to give him a bone.
There will be five laps to go when they come back.
They're ordering lunch. Just put it on the bill.
That's where those ducks were on Friday, doing the same thing during qualifying.
All right, Stewart's got to get a good restart here. Got to get away from Ricky Rudd. Keep the pressure off his rear bumper. Pace cars in. It'll be five to go when they cross the line. There's the outstretched hand. Five laps to go, green flag.
Looks like Kurt Busch, 97. He tried to anticipate that start.
He really did. I think Rudd may have spun the tires a tiny bit, but Kurt thought better of it. I believe Kurt might be able to get by Ricky.
Ricky Rudd shut Kurt Busch down at turn one.
I think Ricky's pretty well used up his stuff trying to hold Tony Stewart off.
He has about four more laps on his tire. See Kurt Busch in the 97 getting real loose off the corner right there.
Jeff Burton has spun. Borisette is off course.
Uh-oh. And that's a shame.
He was running in the 11th position.
Burton's been doing a good job. Got himself up there in a pretty good spot.
But it never fails. This happens with about 5 to 10 laps to go.
Oh, yeah. I've been running 20th here and come home in the top five. Whoa. Yeah. That'll get you a meeting over at the 31 truck. Got more cars spinning.
Jeff Green, not the first time he's gone around today.
We're sure probably not done yet, I'm sure.
There you go, clear, stay after
him. Oops.
Jeff Burton probably wondered what in the world happened.
Well, when you get these guys bunched up here with five to go, inevitably this is what happens.
Tony Stewart in a 20 car, four laps to go. He stretched it out by over a second over Ricky Rudd in the 21.
39 car just went by real slow. Jeff Gordon slow. A lot of problems.
Scott Pruitt in that 39 car been pretty solid all day long.
Here's Robbie Gordon right there for all the problems he's had today. Still running in the top 15 behind Jamie McMurray, and McMurray's had a pretty trouble-free race here.
Yeah, Robbie's looks like he's a good bit better than Jamie is.
But remember, he had one of the best cars at the beginning of the race until he had those transmission problems, got a lap down, got the free pass, trying so hard to get a top 10 finish here today.
I think he just might be able to do it if he can just chill out here a little bit. He got a better car than McMurray does.
And he got a good run right there off turn 10, but so did McMurray.
Yep, that was they were dead even there.
Now Robbie takes that late apex, but he can't beat Jamie off the corner.
No, Jamie accelerated a little harder than he did. Got in the gas a little better. Got him a little breathing room.
Three to go.
minus 3.3.
Stewart climbs the hill, 1.2 seconds ahead of Rudd. Bush, Wallace, Jarrett.
I know Ricky Rudd's got to be just hoping. I bet he doesn't even want to look at his fuel pressure gauge.
Yeah, because he slowly is driving a little bit away from Kurt Busch in a 97 car. It's a good question, big question, with two and a half to go. Does he have enough fuel? Robbie Gordon, the 7, gets by Jamie McMurray to 42. 42 looks like he's going back after him.
Somebody ought to tell him to get up on the road every now and then. Oh, they're not happy.
Oh, he got him.
No, he's not happy.
Got him in the back.
This ain't going to work, boys.
Oh, push comes to shove.
Terry Labonte in 11, not sure
good
what
job,
to do.
Buddy.
And there's,
job,
yeah, there's Greg Biffle back here saying, y'all just wreck each other. I'm back here waiting on you.
Yeah, now Biffle's in position to leave here with the point lead.
I think we'll see why the 42 is maybe after the 7.
Robbie Dirk tracked and got him.
Jamie's waving at him out the left side, and Robbie's going by on the right. I don't think that's doing any good. And now Robbie says, man, I got to get away from this guy. He's hot.
Yes, he is. You can see it in the race car.
He's as hot as that paint job.
Two to go for Tony Stewart in the 20.
Again, Stewart's had a flawless race. He ran Ricky Rudd clean. Tried him hard on the outside at 11, tried to dive bomb him on the inside. When Rudd blocked him, he went and tried the other way, and he waited, let the race come to him. He's led it now, what, three different times, and this could be it.
I sure hope he shaved this morning. I've been on him about that.
Now, one of those cars that pitted on lap 65, 45 laps to go, P.J. Jones in the 4 car, he just ran out of fuel, made it to pit road, fueled, now he's gone. But he would be in that same fuel window as Ricky Rudd in the 21, Rusty Wallace in the 2, Dale Jarrett in the 88, Elliott Sadler in the 38, Jeremy Mayfield in the 19, Ron Fellows in the 32, all in the top 8.
And that's a tough break for the Morgan McClure team. They brought PJ in to drive this car on Sunday to try to stay out of the danger zone by being out of the top 35 in car owner points, and that pit stop will be a tough one for them.
Well, Larry, this is just at that point where you got what you got, buddy.
White flag,
yes, sir, white flag.
If you run out now, just don't even tell me about it.
And it's hard to believe, 109 laps down, one to go, 34 cars still on the lead lap, only one car out of this race.
And that is Tom Hubert.
And Jeff Gordon, who had climbed his way back up into the top 20, all of a sudden had another problem, and he's back in 32nd spot.
So Jimmy Johnson, with him in 32nd, Darrell. Jimmy Johnson in 36th. Dale Earnhardt Jr., 42nd. Tough day for some of the biggest stars of the sport.
Well, we said coming in here today could make a big difference in the points, and it obviously has.
Greg Biffle's going to lead the points for the first time in his Nextel Cup career.
I believe our battle for second is heated up. Rudd here in the 21, looking back at Kurt Busch in the 97.
Guard your inside down there at 11. We're driving deep. Guard your inside.
Boy, they didn't need to tell him, because that's been...
Rudd got a good run off of a 10 there. I think it's going to pay off for him.
And Kurt might not be expecting Rudd to hold the bottom here. Checkered flag will be in the air. 20th career win for Tony Stewart, his 4th Nextel Cup road course victory, and Ricky Rudd holds off Kurt Busch for 3rd, Rusty Wallace, Dale Jarrett, Elliott Sadler, and Ron Fellows is the first of the road course ringers. Nice job by Brian Simo to finish in the top 10 as well.
One happy group right there.
And two cars coast or lip across the line. One is Robbie Gordon. The other is Scott Riggs.
Uh-oh, the other one is Ricky Rudd, the 21 car, but he had enough fuel.
He's done over here. Great job, Ricky.
You know who they're going to call? Mater. Buddy Mater, the tow truck driver.
Oh, yeah, from the movie Cars.
To go pick up Ricky Rudd, but he had enough to finish.
And the difference was that caution that came out there with about 7 laps to go. That was the difference in Ricky Rudd finishing this race or not finishing.
I got to believe it. Ricky and Rusty and probably Dale Jarrett and Elliott Sadler all breathing a sigh of relief.
Well, when you list the road course ringers, list this man. Tony Stewart has now run 4 of the last 9 Nextel Cup races on road courses. Tony Stewart headed for victory lane, and so will we.
Welcome to the Nextel Post Race Show, brought to you by Nextel, helping NASCAR groups get things done. NASCAR and Nextel, partners in speed. Tony Stewart celebrating and making a claim that he might be the new king of the road. Four wins in his last nine road courses. Celebrating victory today after leading the most laps. Chevy congratulates Tony Stewart and the Monte Carlo on today's win. The defending manufacturer's champion taking win number 563 overall. Chevy, the revolution races on with 11 laps to go. That nifty move overtaking Ricky Rudd put him in position after the caution flag and the restart to sail home with his first victory of this year after finishing second three times and leading most laps for the fourth time this season. Tony Stewart in victory lane. And the first win for Joe Gibbs Racing. Greg Biffle, we have a new leader in points for the first time in 13 races, 22 up now on Jimmy Johnson, who had his second worst finish of this season, and Tony Stewart leaping up with that victory to fourth. Let's check in now with Dick Berger.
With Greg Biffle, 22 points up on the point championship. How does this make you feel to come out of a day like this where you started so deep in the field and to have such a good deal?
Yeah, it's a great day for us. You know, we knew it was a matter of time, and we just persistence. We certainly didn't have the run we wanted. It's unfortunate. You know, we had a good strategy there, and that caution really hurt us. You know, lost about 6-8 spots probably. But, you know, what comes around goes around. You know, it's just the way it is. You know, I saw 48 was laughing at us when we went off the track qualifying, and what comes around goes around, I guess. You know, it's a good day for us. You know, we're excited about the way our car ran, good pit stops, and, you know, we're looking forward to Daytona and maybe another win in Chicago.
All right, congratulations. Great job. Let's go to Steve Burns.
And Tony Stewart taking off the seat belts. Tired, but obviously very excited about winning here for the second time at the Infineon Raceway. First win of 2005 and a career win number 20 for the driver of the 20 car, celebrating with Greg Zipadelli. And now, Tony, as you took the checkered flag, I heard you say on the radio, I was driving this car with one hand. What in the world happened?
I lost fourth gear, and then I started losing third gear, and rather than let it break the rest of the way, I was just holding it with one hand and never letting go of it. When I was in first gear and second gear, I could drive it with both hands, but all the fast speed stuff with one hand in third gear, I was getting tough, especially when you're trying to pass Ricky Rudd. So it's hard to try to set a guy up on the fastest part of the track with one hand.
How good does it feel to win this race, Smoke?
It feels great. I mean, we've been close three times this year, and it was just a matter of time. I mean, it's, you know, we got some work to do. We're not in dreamland and thinking that we're where we need to be, but this is one of those races where I don't think it was a dominance by anybody. I mean, we just, you know, we had to go out and do what we had to do today, and we had just as good a car as anybody else. I feel bad for Jeff Gordon and his guys. You know, they did a great job. Jeff drove the wheels off the thing, was smooth all day, and whatever happened to them, they didn't deserve that either. But, you know, it's, you know, it would have been fun to race him for the win. So I know we had a little help there, but, you know, we earned this one having to drive it one-handed like that.
Congratulations, you're a racer. Matt Yoakam.
Lack of fuel ruined Rusty Wallace's chances last year of a top five finish. And what were you thinking when Larry Carter, your crew chief, said we've got fuel issues again?
Oh, man, I about freaked out. He said, Rusty, said, you're not going to believe it. He said, we didn't get the car fuel. We're going to have to pit. So we pitted. We went the tailback, and we're driving along, and I'm thinking, I said, Larry, we got to outthink these cats somehow, you know. And then I was looking at the fuel window about how many laps I thought I could go in fuel, then gambling about how many laps I think we could get one of the cautions, and we short-fitted it. And just stayed out there, didn't take tires or nothing. I kept having the cautions. But look, man, this year I learned that baby gets top that hill, I'd shut that motor off. And I could coast from there all the way behind that old M&M's trail over there. And then I'd fire it back up, run up, shut it off. I ran the whole race with half the motor running, you know. So I learned how to work the fuel, and it worked out good. And I had a good car, too.
Last start here at Infineon Raceway. Rusty Wallace scores a top five finish, guys.
Thanks, Matt. We'd like to talk to Ricky Rudd, but he's still waiting for Mater and the tow truck up there out on the course where he ran out of gas. More storylines and more surprises in our half of the season than in the last 3 years. It's been great.
This is the hardest thing I think I've ever had to do is walk out of this booth today. Not going to Daytona.
But it's so good to see drivers like Rusty Wallace, Mark Martin in their last season. Drivers like Ricky Rudd and Dale Jarrett having good, solid season and a good, solid run today.
Well, We can't wait to see what happens in the second half.
We'll be back.
All right. Thanks, guys. So 16 races, 10 more to the chase. Right now, 13 drivers would make the chase. No Junior, no Jeff Gordon.
Well, it's going to be tough right now for Junior to get back up there. But Jeff Gordon, I believe he'll rebound and be able to climb his way back up in his chase for the championship. So we still have not seen the rest of the story, as they'd say.
And how about what you expect in the second half? You'll still be going to the races for Speed Channel, keeping an eye on things.
Trying to keep an eye on what's going on. And, you know, watching the guys like Jimmy Johnson, see if he can catch and get back in front of Greg Biffle and see if Greg Biffle can keep on that big tear he's been on so far. So it's got a lot of exciting moments coming up and a lot of racing right now. And we don't know who is going to be able to pull it out before we get to Richmond.
After the dominance of Roush and Hendrick Racing, Gibbs Racing into victory land. Nice little shot there, too, verbally from Greg Biffle and Jimmy Johnson. Something fun to watch for as we get our last look at the way the point standings are.
Yeah, a little bit of the feud right now. You see Jeff Gordon's in 14th, 414 points, just outside that magic number, but I believe he'll get back there.
For our entire production and technical crew, DW, Larry, Mike, Matt, Steve, Dick, Jeff, I'm Chris Myers. For the last time this year, we appreciate you watching us. Catch Major League Baseball on Fox, the NFL on Fox, and then we'll see you for NASCAR on Fox back in February. Our thanks to the people of NASCAR, the drivers and the fans, for providing us with another great season of memories and for a record-setting year in terms of viewers on Fox. We wish our colleagues over at NBC much success. So the rest of the season, wish we were there with you, but we'll be watching as you have the chase for the Nextel Cup. So for our entire crew, Tony Stewart winning here, race 16 from Infineon Raceway in Sonoma, California. I'm Chris Myers. Thanks for watching and for being a part of NASCAR on Fox.